Can you have that Adam Schefter sound ready to go that I sent you? Thank you, brother. I appreciate you. Welcome back to another edition of the Rodcast. A beautiful day. Well, if you're a Houston Texans fan, it is a beautiful day. Right as the show was getting done yesterday, big news broke, blockbuster trade. We tried to tell you. I believe we had a couple of segments yesterday talking about Nick Cuccerio, that he was cooking up something. Why was he clearing cap space? They had almost $32 million in cap space. They had restructured a couple of contracts, Titus Howard, Shaq Mason. They were up to something. Now we know exactly what the Texans were up to, a trade for Stephon Diggs. We'll get into that and talk about it. That'll be the big topic here starting off the show. But later on the show, we'll get to some other topics, some mock drafts that are out there, spring football nuggets. We'll get into some spring football practice nuggets and get you that coming up when we go behind the burnt orange curtain. We also will get into, I want to talk a little bit about the Cowboys. Of course, we always get into the Cowboys discussion, but there's a subject I think near and dear to at least Jerry Jones's heart that we got to get into that relates to the Texans. So we'll talk about that. There's some buzz already that Caitlin Clark is already going to be official buzz that she may be a part of the All-Star festivities when she does become an official WNBA player. We'll get you that coming up. There's also a lot of buzz, too, that there may be another opportunity for one of the players in the Final Four to be a two-sport player. Potentially at the highest levels. We'll talk about that. We got some audio coming up a little bit later on the show. So tons to get into. We got your what the facts, what the stats. We got your big fat poll of the day coming up with my man Patrick Davis. We also got off the record coming up. We got who said that, the usual suspects, but we also got a lot of the top headlines of the day. Speaking of that, we got your Horn headlines coming up momentarily. The man who actually takes care of the Horn headlines and so many other duties here on the Rodcast. He is the real MVP, one of the hardest working members of the ARN family. He's got a hustler spirit, period. I don't know what he's paid, but I'm pretty damn sure he's underpaid. Ain't no 401k for this hustler. And he's a hustle man of many talents. He's my friend, co-host, and neighbor. It's Patrick Davis, y'all. What's going on, Patrick? How you doing, brother?
Oh, it's a Thursday. We made it over hump day. It is a good day to be a Texans fan. Wow. I was on the phone. I got multiple bandwagon request forms sent in by Cowboys fans and my text messages yesterday.
Yeah. Sorry, Cowboys fans.
People starting to get a little upset at Jerry and starting to be a little envious of the Texans. Mm-hmm. Also, a little bit we had on social media, a couple people were not fully on board with the trade, but we'll get into that. We'll talk about it.
Hey, you don't have to agree with the trade. That's okay.
But let me introduce you to my co-host, who I know is happy about the trade as well. My co-host is a proud alumni of DBU. He's got more papers than Dunder Mifflin and watches more film than Siskel and Ebert. He is the new Rod Father of Austin Sports Radio, Mr. Rod Babers.
I appreciate the intro as always. Yeah, not everybody has to agree with the trade, but you know my favorite word, Patrick, when it comes to talent acquisition or even the offseason, it's value.
Yes.
Value.
Yes.
That is the word of the day. We should play that that Pee Wee Herman clip, you know, back in the Pee Wee Herman's playoffs. They had the word of the day. Word of the day. And all the little characters would go crazy. Yeah. I feel like value would be one of those terms, word of the day for us, because I think that's what Nick Cuccerio got a lot in return. They got a lot of value when you're looking at it. Now, whether you want to debate about whether you think Stephon Diggs is the receiver that he was 4 years ago, that's a discussion that we can have. But, I mean, he's a 1,000-yard receiver. Think about this. The Texans have acquired. I know we'll get to it because we got my man Patrick with the Horn headlines. The big fat poll today is always a good conversation. You are the most important part of the show, so please participate. 512-447-3776 on the text line. But in one offseason, you've acquired a 1,000-yard receiver, a 1,000-yard running back, and a defender with double-digit sacks. I mean, according to CBS Sports, that's never happened before. a team in one offseason acquiring that much
you know, that much talent in the offseason. And that is, I mean, you're right. I mean, Cowboys fans have to be looking at the Texans like some hungry kids looking at somebody who's eating a whole lot of chicken fried steak and mashed potatoes and won't share. Because they got grumbling bellies right now, rumbling bellies, and it's right now what the Texans are doing is something that I don't think any team in the NFL right now is in a position to do. Number one, because of C.J. Stroud and what he's done, and having the discount, essentially having the what I think is the maybe the best advantage in all of major American pro sports is to have a rookie quarterback who you consider a franchise quarterback on that rookie deal. And now it's the time to spend, and Nick Caserio is not wasting any of that time.
Yeah. No, he's going right after it. And you see, it's when you talk about trying to play chess, not checkers, that trade with the Vikings a week or so ago to get the second round picks and everything that he's been kind of working on this offseason, clearing the cap space. We talked a lot about yesterday that it keeps being that it seems like he has a plan in place and things keep falling into the plan. And even though they were looking at Keenan Allen earlier this offseason, and they were in those trade discussions, they weren't able to get the price they wanted. They weren't able to get what they wanted. That did not deter them from continuing on the quest to go get a wide receiver one that they really felt could come in and play this season, something that they didn't feel they were going to be able to get at pick 23.
Yeah. It's just fun having a GM as aggressive as Nick Caserio for your team.
Yes.
Because he, like I said, he's made more trades in the NFL than any GM since he's become the GM of the Texans. That was also the case in last year's draft. He made more trades than anybody else in the draft. A lot of people believe he's going to be really aggressive in this draft, making moves. And I would say that I believe most of the trades that I observe, and some of them are small and not this big in terms of being a blockbuster trade, but I think the Texans are on the winning side a lot of these trades that I'm looking at for Nick Caserio. So I'll give him a ton of credit for that. I think he does a great job of acquiring a value. But as a fan, it's just fun because he's always making moves. I mean, he kind of reminds me of Howie Roseman in that aspect. He's constantly making moves and upgrading the roster, churning out the roster. So this is another big one, and this is why they were clearing the cap space. And we knew they wanted a receiver, right? You talked about the Keenan Allen deal. You referenced that they wanted Keenan Allen. It didn't work out for him. The reports were in this draft, they wanted a wide receiver, but, the reports were their first round grades, essentially, revealed that they didn't believe there would be the wide receiver that they wanted, that they had a first round grade on, dropped to them at 23 where they were drafting. So, you know, trade out of the first round, get more value in the second round, which they did. And you see what they did with all those picks that they acquired.
And I think with Caserio, you see the fact too, that this is a guy that it feels like because the Texans were kind of out of the spotlight for so long and they've had the turnaround that he's getting a lot of credit and looked at as, well, he's this new GM that's kind of coming in doing these things. I think he knew too that there's a point of him that did have two really bad seasons where they were rebuilding, had fired two coaches. He's on his third coach, and that he may not have the leniency to build that some other newer guys may have, that because of, you know, promises that were possibly made behind the scenes and discussions where I can turn this team around in this and we can get this done in this amount of time, that he's maybe on a different clock than we're putting him on because, the discussions he could have had with Cal McNair 3 or 4 years ago could have been, well, I can have this team competing in the playoffs in 4 years, even with the rebuild. We can be back and fighting. And so his clock is at a different point than we're putting this as year two of the rebuild. For him, this is not year two. This is year four.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with that. I agree with the year four thing. I'm with you. I actually, that's the way I was looking at it too. You're right. Most people probably see it as year two and that they're ahead of schedule. I do see it as year four because I count the back-to-back one-and-done coaches. Yeah. You know what I mean? As a Texan, you've been deep in this, right? At one time, renounced your fandom because you were so frustrated with the Texans. So that's what I remember, too. But, apparently that was just him adjusting on the fly. And like I said, he's the first GM in the Super Bowl era, ladies and gentlemen, to be allowed, to be given the – to as a GM, right? to even be given the option to hire a third coach after firing two back-to-back one-and-done coaches. Every other instance that I found in the Super Bowl era that's happened, the owner decided, all right, you don't know what the hell you're doing. You're out. You got back-to-back one-and-done coaches. No, you're the one who's out. You're done. And the only other two times where you look at it where it's happened, and they had back-to-back one-and-done coaches, but they did change GMs. The San Francisco 49ers actually did it twice. They had back-to-back one-and-done coaches. The San Francisco 49ers had it in 76 and 77. They actually had three. They had three consecutive one-and-done coaches. The 49ers, crazy. They did change GMs once in that time span, but they had three, 76, 77, 78, and then they hire Bill freaking Walsh in 79. Boom. Knock it out of the park. In 2015, 2016, they had back-to-back one-and-dones, Jim Tomsula and Chip Kelly, and then they hired my man Shano, and hopefully he ends up winning a Super Bowl for them. We don't know. And then the Texans are the only other team to go back-to-back one-and-done coaches, David Culley, Lovie Smith, and hopefully they knocked it out of the park. Seems like it with D'Amico Ryan. So maybe it is something to screwing it up so badly that you're like, you know what? No, I think I figured it out. I've made all the mistakes I can make. I figured out the worst way to do it. So now, inevitably, I can work backwards. I can reverse engineer my decision-making and make a much better decision on who should be the coach. At least it happened with the 49ers. Looks like it might have happened with the Texans too.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely something to look at. And I mean, to realize that even, last offseason, the conversation for the Texans was, Lovie Smith screwed you because he gave you the number two pick because he won that last game. That was a conversation an offseason ago. That was a year ago today. We were discussing how there was such a shame that Lovie Smith had to win that last game, and he went out because he knew he was getting fired, and he screwed the Texans, and now they're going to lose out on Bryce Young probably, and that is going to hamstring the franchise. That was a conversation a year ago. So it is crazy to be a year later than that and have the conversation now about Stephon Diggs leaving a team with Josh Allen and being excited about it probably to come to the Texans. That seems like a far reach to go there, but it was good news for the Texans. And there's a lot of stuff we can get into on this trade that gives it that extra. What's the word of the day, Rod?
Value.
That's what value. There's reasons beyond just getting a wide receiver one, which I know on social media yesterday we posted about it, and to people got upset that I used the word bona fide wide receiver one. And I said, he'd be a wide receiver one on 20 plus teams in this league. That gives me, that's why I would say bona fide. I get that he's 30 years old. I get that there was points in the end of the season where he did not play his best football, but I still believe he would be a wide receiver one on about 20 teams in the league. So I'm still saying he's a bona fide a wide receiver one. Did not say elite. Didn't say he's CeeDee Lamb, but we do say he is a wide receiver one. That's where you go. And that's what the Texans really wanted in this trade, because you want to bring in somebody that has a little bit more experience. You want to bring in somebody that you feel you can use in those situations. And as much as they would say, well, he may, in the red zone, you still have Dalton Schultz and Joe Mixon and Nico Collins and Tank Dell and Noah Brown. There's a lot of options you can still throw to, but you need somebody that the defense knows they have to cover. You need somebody that was also in that conversation. And as much as Noah Brown is a good player, he cannot get separation the way Stephon Diggs can get separation. And there's just different things Stephon Diggs brings that changes what the defense does. That will be great for Tank Dell. That'll be great for Stephon Diggs. It'll be great for Joe Mixon. It'll be great for Dalton Schultz, all those guys. And of course, great for CJ Stroud.
To your point though, about the bona fide number one, I will say that, he's one of two wide receivers, one of only two wide receivers to have 100+ receptions in each of the last four seasons.
Yeah.
It's him and Davante Adams. I mean, the guy, the production does say that he's a bona fide, as you point out, bona fide number one for at least more than half the teams in the NFL. He would be. He's really, really productive, and you're bringing that productivity to a young quarterback. And you can tell they're in win now mode. That's the reason for bringing in an aging wide receiver like him. Yeah, his window, to be at least playing at this level is probably 2 to 3 years. That's your window.
Yeah.
There's going back to my the kind of the golden rule of NFL roster construction and talent acquisition. You got a 5-year window, and there's never been in the history of the NFL, at least the Super Bowl era, there has never been a head coach and the same quarterback win their first Super Bowl together, all right, outside of that 5-year window. It's never taken a head coach and a quarterback, that duo, more than 5 years to win their first Super Bowl together. So if you, that's what Buffalo's doing. They're on the other side of this. Buffalo's like, we got to reset the window. We got to reset the salary cap. We got to reset everything. We're past it now. We got to do something a little bit more drastic. This is part of it. They've changed coordinators. They're right now just trying to figure out their new window. The truth is, it's probably going to be a new head coach that can help them do it. That's just the reality of the way the NFL is built. The CBA is constructed. The salary cap, it's all built. Because after that 5-year window, you got to start paying guys. That's why Nick Caserio is Brewster's millions right now. He's like, no, I got to spend. I'm spending. I got the money. Because after that 5-year window, I got to pay CJ. Do you notice how all the contracts are lining up 2 to 3 years? Because that's when he's got to pay CJ.
Yeah.
I got to line these things up because I need all this money off the books. Because CJ is going to be the highest paid player in the history of the NFL if all goes according to plan. And I need all y'all's money off the books so I can pay him. And then we can start figuring out. But in that, before I pay him, I want to win the Super Bowl. And this is the best chance you got. After you pay him, you can still win a Super Bowl, but it's not going to be as easy. This is the NFL is rewarding you. The NFL does, just like Uncle Sam rewards you for certain things that boost the economy and they're good for the country, right? You're going to get tax breaks for having kids. They want you to have deductions. All right, so you have kids. That's good. They think families are good for the economy. You're a business owner. Boom, you're going to get some tax breaks because we think small business is good for the economy. You own your own land. Oh, that's great for the economy. We're going to give you a little tax break on that, right? You don't get tax breaks for things that are good for the economy. The NFL does the same thing with the CBA. Young quarterbacks, thriving, really good for the game. We're going to give you a tax break, baby. We put a rookie wage scale on them. So you got about 3 or 4 years. Think of it like this. Everybody, most people's number one expense and their number most expensive bill, the most expensive thing they have to pay for every day is either rent or mortgage, right? That's what everybody's got to pay for. And imagine, hell, you know, in New York City, they got rent control where the rent has to stay at a certain rate. All right, in certain buildings for certain circumstances. And basically what you're getting quarterback on rent control. Like that's the most expensive and the biggest expense for any NFL team is paying their franchise quarterback to face their team. For 3 or 4 years, you get them at a discounted rate, like a 70% discount. And what would you do with all the money you could save if you get a 70% discount on your rate or your mortgage for about 4 years? How much debt would you pay off? What would you buy with all that extra money? Would you just save it? You could just save it if you wanted to for a rainy day. But most Americans would spend it. And basically, you can spend it to make more money. Basically, that's good for the economy. But and the NFL thinks the same thing. They want you to spend that money. They want you to bring in free agents. They're giving you that discount. And Nick Caserio is going to use it. He's going to use it. There's no doubt. He's using it right now. It's a beautiful
thing. And you mean it's worth noting as well that they've kind of compounded what that window is of paying CJ because you drafted a defensive end, a pick behind him that you're hoping will again grow as a player and he has to get paid as well. So you're talking about paying the number 2 and number 3 pick in the same draft. That is going to be that bill's going to come due on both sides of the ball. Agreed. At the same time. So it adds to that window, but part of that Diggs trade that you love, he doesn't have any guaranteed money after this year. So you're basically free and clear that if, you know, you're 2 years down the line, I doubt he's going to be okay playing on the last year of that contract. So either you have to move on from him then or whatever you want to do. He's probably not. I just don't see Stefon Diggs necessarily being thrilled to play on. I believe it's like $14.5 million in the last year of his contract. No guaranteed money. He'll be like 33, 34. I could see him being a guy who may want to either get a re-up or trade or wherever it is. So you probably have three seasons with him being there, but that's fine. If you get 3 seasons out of a guy who's as wide receiver 1 for a second round pick, that could be something else. You know, if you really nailed it, you might be able to get five seasons out of a guy. That's, you know, because the years you're talking about building him up at two-way wide receiver one, and then those years, and then you're paying him normally for those wide receiver one years. That part of it too, when you talk about the value of this trade, that you're able to get a guy that is a wide receiver one who's not really on a bad wide receiver one contract.
No.
It's under it's 20 like, mil a year.
He's like 16th highest paid receiver or something like that.
And there's not guaranteed money past this year, that even if people are correct and he is going to be a huge diva and this huge problem and everything else, even if all of those ugly parts rear their head, you can get out of it. There's no problem that the Bills are actually losing cap space trading him. their cap number for him went up because it was like 27 mil and now it's 31 mil. So it actually went up to get rid of him. And the Texans are getting the back end of that, which is basically once this season's over, they're free and clear that he is playing on house money where he'll still be making 18 and 19 million. But if they need to get out of it, or if he's unhappy, first of all, he's easily tradable without taking a cap hit.
That's true.
And you're also able to, so to me, that value for it right now. And we know that he also gave Joe Mixon a new contract when he came in. I don't think he would do this on a guy with 4 years left on a deal, but you never know. Just depending on how, you know, trying to keep Stephon Diggs happy. But the difference is Joe Mixon was playing in the last year of a contract. Stephon Diggs is playing on the first year of a 4 year extension.
Yeah, you got him.
So it's a bit different of how that works out. But I think that value wise, you know, when you talk about taking a first round pick this year, pick 23 in this year's draft, and you turn it in to a second round pick in this year's draft, Stephon Diggs and a sixth and a seventh. That's what you turn the first rounder into. You move back like 15 picks. You move back like 15 picks and you get Stephon Diggs and a sixth and a seventh. I don't know if there's a GM in the league who wouldn't take that trade. And I get some couldn't afford to take it, but I don't know anyone who in Nick Cazero's position would not take that trade. I think most people would look at it and say, that is an insane value you just got.
Yep. Like I said, it's the word of the day, and it should be, because Nick Caserio, I guarantee you that's his priority each and every time he makes these acquisitions. Real quick, before we get to the horn headlines here, because I know we're up against it, the Bills, to your point, they will carry about a $31 million dead money hit for Diggs. They wound up paying an extra $20.9 million in 2022 and 2023 to basically come away with a net of less than a second rounder if you're looking at the value of it. The Texans will inherit the $19 million in cash, essentially, that they owe to Stephon Diggs, $18.5 million in base salary, and he has a $250,000 workout bonus and like a roster bonus too of $255,000 as well. But the Bills have $43.8 million in dead money to work through because of the Stephon Diggs deal. They want it out. It is clear they want it out. Whatever they were like, I mean, they what's the old saying? Divorce is expensive because it's worth it. That is essentially what they're saying here. They're like, no, divorce. It's worth it. Pay every damn penny. We want out. So I'm not really concerned about that, though. But they definitely wanted this done because they took a huge hit when they didn't necessarily
have to. And we know that the theory is now there was a social media post where somebody it was basically an article about does Josh Allen need Stephon Diggs or not? And the guy said, basically somebody posted that they did not need him, that it was not necessary. And Diggs said, are you sure about that? And was traded the next day. I think that there is a point, but again, when you talk about, you just talked about the window. I think the Bills are trying to avoid the uncomfortable elephant in the room that they should have fired Sean McDermott 2 years ago. Yeah. And they should have tried something new. And they're really hanging on to this thread of now Mitch Morris, the GM, and everybody over there understands now that they kind of screwed up and are behind the eight ball and trying to figure out the way out of it. But they should have taken this leap of faith a couple of years ago and tried to find a new way in. And now they're hanging on and trying to play with house money to figure out to, okay, how do we try? And we're in debt. We got to try and get out of this.
What's they, they call it? The sunk cost fallacy?
Yeah.
They're doubling down. They're just like, you know, and what? We're already here. Let's go. And I'm with you. It should have been 2 years ago.
And that was the, and then I think it's, you know, where the Cowboys kind of have their thing and the Bills are in theirs. Well, if you don't want to be here, we don't want you here. We need good attitudes is how we're going to win this Super Bowl. It was bad attitudes keeping us from winning the Super Bowl, even though everybody knows it's, you're sitting in a situation where of course there's going to be bad attitudes because everyone knows the window's closing. And as good as Josh Allen is,
yeah,
you went out and you spent more and brought in a Von Miller and it didn't work out the way you wanted to. And you tried to bring in these guys, and now Gabe Davis leaves, and now Stephon Diggs. And so you're going to have a different wide receiver core completely next year for them. And they'll be able to rebuild. They'll be an okay team because Josh Allen's that good. But I don't know if that's – I think for them, there's a point of it. There's discontent in the locker room, and this seemed like a swipe at the discontent in the locker room. We will take out one of the people we think was at the head of the discontent. And for whatever reason, he did not want to be here. So if we can take him out, maybe that'll teach everybody else to fall in line and know where the bread is buttered and come in this locker room with a good attitude. Whether that works or not, who knows? But I don't know if you know, addition by subtraction will work in this scenario for the Bills. And for the Texans, you hope that you have a C.J. Stroud who is a young, vibrant, positive leader. You have a D'Amico Ryans who's a young, vibrant, positive leader. And you hope that there's enough faces like that in the locker room that you can get the 2 to 3 years out of Stephon Diggs. That's all you really want. You don't necessarily, yeah. This is not a 6-7 year. We're trying to get him forever signing or trade. So that, man, if we can get 2 or 3, keep that window and we can hit it there. And then hopefully we'll draft somebody in second, third round, like they did Tank Dell, and that person can come up and be the next guy, or maybe use a first round pick next year or the year after. And find another wide receiver that will build up to be the next wide receiver one, or maybe it's Nico Collins and you need a wide receiver too, but whatever that scenario is, I'm not as worried about it. It could rear its head. We know it could. But again, if he had $100 million in guaranteed money, the value's not there. But with no guaranteed money, at worst case scenario, you missed on a second round pick.
Yeah, no doubt about that. I think you're right on the money. I'll also say this. There's been trade rumors around Stephon Diggs for a little while now.
Yeah.
And remember at the beginning of training camp, you know, last training camp, I believe, he didn't show up early on, and then there were questions about whether he was upset or displeased. So there's been some tension there for a little while. I don't think this is something that is new, and ultimately the Texans took advantage of that. All right, before we get to the Behind the Burnt Orange Curtain segment, we'll talk some Texas spring football. Let's hit your horn headlines real quick, get you educated, updated, and informed on all the big stories of the day, including the one we just discussed with Stephon Diggs headed to the Texans in a blockbuster trade that happened early yesterday.
All right, your Horn Headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball begins their weekend series with BYU at Dish Falk Field tonight. Texas will stick with the rotation of LeBaron Johnson Jr., Ace Whitehead, and Max Grubbs for starting pitching. And the current league leaders in home runs, Jalen Flores and Max Ballou, will hope to keep their hot bats alive against a BYU team that is at the bottom of the Big 12 standings. The Houston Texans agreed to a blockbuster trade yesterday, sending a 2025 second-round pick to the Buffalo Bills for wide receiver Stephon Diggs and two late round draft picks. This is the latest move by the Texans after signing multiple big name defensive free agents and trading for running back Joe Mixon earlier this offseason. With the NBA regular season winding down, the Houston Rockets play a must win game tonight against the Golden State Warriors. Houston is currently 3 games out of the 10 seed and playing tournament behind Golden State. And the Mavericks will be in action against the Hawks, looking to make up ground on a Clippers team who will have their hands full facing the Denver Nuggets. And in the MLB, both the Astros and Rangers are off today as the Rangers won their second series of the season against the Rays after a 4-1 victory yesterday with Eovaldi pitching 7 solid innings. And the Astros got their win over the Blue Jays 8-0, powered by Yordan Alvarez's 2 home runs. The two teams will meet each other for the first time this season starting Friday in Arlington. That is your Horn Headlines.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the Horn Headlines. One thing also I'm going to try to research, because I haven't heard it, but I got to do some scrounging around on the internet to see. who initiated this trade, the Bills or the Texans. I don't know if you've heard that or not, Patrick, but I did hear Adam Schefter, and we have the audio. We'll play it for you. Adam Schefter did actually confirm that the Texans were the ones who initiated the trade with Minnesota, that it wasn't the Minnesota Vikings who were reaching out to the Texans trying to get another first-round pick so they can move up. Now, maybe that's something they were considering, obviously, but it was the Texans, Nick Cook-Serio, who initiated the trade. And I bet my theory is that he initiated this one too, but I want to go get confirmation on that. I want to see if I can find like Ian Rappaport confirming that, who initiated, because usually they don't release who initiated the trades first. That comes out a little bit later on, just like it came out the Texans are the ones who initiated the trade with Minnesota. So I want to find out who initiated this trade. I think that might be important. It could have been because it easily could have been the Bills saying, "Hey man, we want out of this deal. Hey, that guy in H-Town, he makes a lot of moves." Because now Nick Caserio has a reputation.
Yeah.
So if you want to make a deal, who's the number one deal maker in the NFL right now? It's Nick Caserio. He's willing to make a deal. So at least you call him up and say, "Hey man, are you willing to make a deal?" If you look at the roster and some of your, obviously it's a compatible trade with them. So I'm not sure if he's reaching, if all these teams are reaching out to Nick Caserio, or if Nick Caserio is deciding, no, I'm being aggressive. I'm the one who's initiating these deals. That certainly was the case with the Minnesota one. So we'll talk about that a little bit later on too. I think it's a really important aspect of it. A lot of layers to this thing. As you can hear from Patrick and I breaking it down from so many different levels, from different angles. But let's hit a different story here. Let's go to Texas spring football discussion. Next segment, we're going behind the burnt orange curtain. Great practice news, notes, and nuggets from my friends over at On Texas Football. Bobby Burton, Jerry Hamilton, CJ Vogel and the crew. I'll hit some of those coming up on the other side. We'll also discuss something that I'm really interested in on the defensive side of things. They got some new coaching additions. I think one of them could have a huge macro impact on the type of personnel Texas could be playing. We'll get into that a little bit later on when we go behind the burn-on curtain. So all of that and more when we continue. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Davis. Want to get to some of the spring practice news notes and nuggets. Our friends over at On Texas Football are doing a really good job over there. So shout out to them. That's where I got most of these. Apparently, and I talked to my man CJ Vogel about this yesterday, and it's a good problem to have. It's a first world problem. There is a lot of rotation now going on at the left guard position on the offensive line. You're trying to get your best five out there, whoever they may be. But Neto Umeazulu was getting a lot of the first team reps last week early on in spring practice. And the reports are now from our friends over at On Texas that now you have Hayden Connor getting some of those reps, and you could even have another option with Cole Husson, but Hayden Connor now rotating in, getting some of those reps at the left guard position. So it's a, like I said, first world problem that you have the depth to rotate those guys, that Hayden Connor now can get first team reps, and you believe both these guys are capable of being starters for you at the left guard position. I don't think this position will be settled in spring. I think ultimately, when you look at the few spots that are open competitions on the 4-day, because most players are competing for reps and competing for target share, and they're competing for snaps because you're rotating guys because you're so deep. And on the offensive line, that'll be the case at times, but offensive line is the most, I think we're talking about, it's the most hive-minded of positions where they have to play as a unit. So you want them to have more reps together as a unit. And if you look at most teams, they're probably the fewest, if you can help it, you know, injuries aside, fewest rotations of any position group on a football field is probably the offensive line, because you want them to have that cohesion, that continuity together. So you're trying to get your find out who your best five are. Patrick, I don't think they'll find that out in the spring. I think that's what these rotations are about. They're halfway through the spring, and they pretty much split those reps at the left guard. We know Kelvin Banks is your anchor at left tackle. Jake Majors is another anchor for you right in the middle at center, returning starters for you, multiple-year starters for you. On the right side, you're a little bit more inexperienced with DJ Campbell at that right guard, and then I think we all agree, Cam Williams. I don't know if there's been any competition really there that we've heard about or has been reported during the spring. So yes, Cam Williams. So it's inexperienced, but there's a lot of upside with both of those guys, and they're going to maul people in the run game. So it's really that left guard position and finding out which one of those guys represents the best five of the O-line.
Yeah, and who works well together. And, you know, you talk about, you know, helping each other by finding people whose strengths, you know, cover up for other people's weaknesses, all of those pieces together. But, you know, if you talk about Sark's trust with wide receivers, as much as we talk about that, there is a point of Quinn's trust with that offensive line as well. And you'd like to have your five guys that Quinn says, these are my guys. These are ride or die. I will take care of them. My NIL money, I'll make sure all these guys are doing great. But these are my five guys that I believe are trying to help me get to the NFL and try and help me win a national championship, because they're going to stand right in front of me and make sure I don't get killed every play.
Yeah, man. You got to take care of the O-line, every quarterback, especially now with the NIL money.
Yeah.
Oh, man, you got to take them out to eat like a few times a week. You should be anyway. You got to buy them gifts on special occasions and all stuff like that. But, hey, the O-line deserves – that's some – I believe – we'll play that Jim Harbaugh quote, because I think we haven't played it yet. But I know I've said to my man Patrick of him talking about the offensive line, the most unselfish unit.
Yeah,
on the team, which I think is I think he's actually right about that. I think he's accurate in that assessment. Anyway, I digress. Getting back to the news notes and nuggets here from my friends over at Owen, Texas, about spring practice. Ryan Wingo continues to get high, a lot of praise, high praise. Remember, Sark mentioned him among the only freshmen that were standing out and separating in spring practice so far. And hearing these reports says Ryan Wingo has been very good. He's still working on his route running, but he is not backing down. He has not hit the freshman wall. So he's continued to get high praise, whether that be in practice reports, whether that be members of the media in the media window, whether that be Sark himself. I do think he's going to expand that circle of trust of wide receivers and the wide receiver rotation. I think Ryan Wingo gets sprinkled in. I don't know if he's going to be a guy that's in the regular rotation. I do think he's a guy that get sprinkled in games where you're up big. And later on in the season, maybe when his route running is a little bit more refined, maybe you do get him out there in more critical situations. I think red zone wise, actually might be able to help you right away just because of his frame and his explosivity. The red zone, especially if you're trying to get him to recreate or replicate the AD Mitchell role, where it's like, all right, man, we're going to have you out there with an option route and one-on-one. Go win, right? It could be a fade. It could be a fade stop. It could be a back shoulder fade. You know what I mean? You could, if the leverage is right, we just turn it into a slant. It's going to be you one-on-one and you and Quinn, and it's a two-man game pretty much. You could go that route with him, I think, in the red zone, and he may be able to help you out early on. But there's no doubt Ryan Wingo continues to be the class of that freshman class. He's the guy that's probably been mentioned the most as someone who's going to make an impact early. I think there will be some other guys like Alex January and Colin Simmons and Xavier Filsimi that will also contribute. But in terms of making an impact, not just contributing, he might be the guy, but he's so freakish. I pulled out my notes yesterday when we were talking about him after Sark mentioned him. And I pulled out my initial notes when I first watched Ryan Wingo, because Jerry Hamilton gave me a recommendation, saying, man, you got to watch this kid. He's legit. He's a real deal. And he's coming to Texas. And so I went and watched film. Here's my first notes on watching Ryan Wingo. Balance, body control, dangerous with the ball in his hands, because he was a punt returner too. Location acceleration, meaning when the ball is thrown and he locates it, he hits a different gear. Accelerates out of his breaks. He's great at making contested catches. He thrives in it in terms of contested catches when they're 50-50 balls. And he can make you miss in a phone booth. I think the most underrated part of his game is that he actually, when he gets the ball in his hands, he's hard to tackle and hard to bring down because he's so twitchy. So he's an explosive athlete, and he hasn't learned how to run routes. And I put that here. I said, hasn't mastered the art of route running. Now starting to study with a wide receiver coach and master the nuances of the wide receiver position. That's what I put down there. So he wasn't a polished route runner in high school. He still isn't one, based on the report here from Bobby saying Ryan Wingo has been very good. He's still working on his route running. When that actually becomes something that's a strength from his route running, then you're going to see his game elevate even more.
Yeah. And if that's, you know, one of your issues, that's something you can continue to work on. It's always trying to figure out guys that have, you know, their weaknesses are things that you can work on and are teachable things. And route running, there is something innate about it. There's certain guys who are just really, really good at it. But it is also something that you can run drills on. You can continue to practice. You can continue to learn on. And you can get really, really good at it just by practice. You don't necessarily have to be born as a route runner. You can work and get much better at it.
That I do agree with 100%. Another report here, because I don't want to give everything away. I want you guys to go check it out for yourself. They got a lot of these great nuggets over there at ontexasfootball.com. We have talked a lot about the defense and the defensive edges and how good they're going to be. We expect the secondary to be a strength as well. The two areas where I think Longhorn fans are concerned most about on defense, interior D-line and that off-ball linebacker opposite Anthony Hill. Well, here's a good report. It says Tia Savea has been singled out as perhaps the best interior run stopper, at least thus far. He probably anchors better than the rest of those guys. So the Savea pickup might be a little bit more impactful and beneficial than we initially thought. And actually, guys, he may be the only one there that's got a lot of experience playing the zero technique. Playing actual nose tackle, which he did at times there at Arizona. It's not ideal. You don't really have a true nose tackle. I guess Adair Mitchell kind of would be that guy, but he's underperformed and underwhelmed so far, especially at 372 or whatever he is. You don't really have a true nose, so Alex January might be able to help you there early on. But Savea is a guy that's actually played that zero technique at Arizona, so he might be able to help you there. At least if you're going to money ball that position, because you don't really have it on the roster, that will be something they are seeking in the transfer portal. I can guarantee you that as soon as the new transfer portal window opens. So good news there. At least Savea is showing a lot of return on that investment of acquiring him in the transfer portal. And remember, he's a guy that knows the Johnny Nansen system. We don't talk a lot about this. I want to get into this a little bit later on about Johnny Nansen and his defensive system, because he was with him there at Arizona. He's the co-DC, so I do wonder if he's going to have some influence on PK.
He might.
He's the co-DC. Yeah, I don't know exactly how, but I can theorize and hypothesize about
it. I like it. I like it.
Yeah, so we'll do that a little bit later on. Okay, those are a couple of the nuggets from our friends at On Texas Football. I encourage you to go over there yourself. They got a lot of good information over there as well. All right, we will get back to talking about the Stephon Diggs trade, the blockbuster trade for the Texans, because I got a question from my man Patrick and a question for all you guys out there. And a matter of fact, the big fat poll today will be a good question. But are the Texans now considered – the Chiefs are the class of the NFL, period. But in the AFC, where do the Texans rank now in the AFC? I want to get into that discussion, too, because I've heard people now, heard Keyshawn Johnson say it. I heard Lewis Riddick say it. I was looking at some other different programs, and they mentioned it as well, that the Texans are right behind the Kansas City Chiefs. The Texans are right behind the Chiefs and the Ravens. And I was thinking to myself, slow down. Oh, let's slow down just a little bit.
Yeah, you know,
pump the brakes.
Hey, see, this is people who cover the Texans and the Cowboys. I think we may be a little bit more worried about offseason hype than some other people.
Right? I'm like, whoa, because they I heard Keyshawn Johnson say, like I said, Lewis Riddick was out there. There's another analyst on NFL Network. It's like, oh, no, basically the only team better than the Texans are the Chiefs and the Ravens. And I'm like, man, I don't know. What about the Bengals? Bengals are, I think I like the Bengals. Bengals are a pretty damn good team that's been there and done that. But I will admit, it's an interesting conversation, because there's not a lot of teams right now that I would put ahead of the Texans in the AFC. Not a lot, but I don't want to be as brash and cocky and arrogant as to say, oh, only they're right behind the Chiefs. But remember, I played the audio of you, for you guys, and I played it probably a month or so ago, something like that, of Nick Wright, who is probably the biggest Kansas City fan out there, also an analyst who's done radio in Houston and in Kansas City. And when he was asked who's the biggest threat in the AFC to the Kansas City Chiefs, he said probably the Texans. That was prior to the Stephon Diggs deal, prior to NFL free agency. He was just looking at the possibility, and he said, oh, no, it's probably the Texans. And now I imagine he's probably willing to double down on that opinion that, oh, no, it's definitely the Texans. So are the Texans the biggest threat to the Kansas City Chiefs? That is the real question. And yeah. I don't know.
I mean, you have to put in there, do they pass Buffalo now with that trade?
I think so.
But you have to have the question. And then I think it is the biggest part of it all is, who has Kansas City not embarrassed yet? And it's this Texans team. That's really, because they've knocked off the Bengals. They've knocked off the Bills. They've knocked off the Ravens. They've gotten rid of all these other teams. So now they're saying, well, who's the next competitor to step up? So I don't know. I think some of these is not so much, are they better than these other teams, but they haven't been beaten yet.
Yeah,
so
they next.
This Texans team has not been embarrassed by the Chiefs yet. So let's figure out there. But I agree. I mean, we know the Bengals made it to the Super Bowl not that many years ago.
Yeah.
So that's a team that, yes, Joe Burrow's health is a question. But if he is healthy, can that be a team that goes in there? Is T. Higgins going to play this season for them? There are questions around the Bengals, but you can't. I don't think you can write them off because Burrow is hurt for most of the season.
Yeah. No, I'm with you. And they're approaching that 5-year window too.
Yeah, there's going to be close to air of desperation in that room.
Yes, no doubt about it. All right, no, there's a lot of layers to that Stephon Diggs trade, and one of them is, are the Texans the biggest threat to the Kansas City Chiefs? A lot of people certainly think so. I want to see it a little bit more. I want to see it now with all the pieces they've added. But it's hard for me to name a lot of teams that I would take ahead of the Texans, other than, of course, the Kansas City Chiefs. And I like what you said. It's more about who's got next for the Kansas City Chiefs. Like, who else? Who wants some of this?
Yeah.
And I think the Texans right now, they want some, and they're going all in to do it. All right. Big fat poll today coming up on the other side. We'll also get into the whatever the musically themed day of the week is. All of that and more when we return right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Davis, coming back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Let's talk about our friends over at Callahan's. I had my man Charlie Wilson on yesterday for, and Omar Uresti as well. Got to show Omar some love for our At the Turn segment. Of course, we talk a little golf and have a lot of fun in that segment. We also talk about lawn care. We talk about what Callahan's can do for you, and they can do so much for you. As a matter of fact, they're the reason right now that my lawn is starting to look a whole lot better because we killed a lot of the weeds, put down the pre-emergence that Charlie recommended for us, the Barricade product from Nitrofos, put down the weed and feed that you also can get from Callahan's General Store. That'll grow the good grass, start to keep the crab grass down, the dandelions out of the yard. And as the temperature starts to change here, we're getting in deeper and deeper into the spring. Once you get those weeds out of the yard and you're starting to grow some of that really good grass, you want to make sure that you fill in the patches. And that's what I got right now. I got patches of grass that I got to fill in, damaged grass, dead grass from winter freezes and the temperature changes, and also from from the heat damage as well. But you can get the Bermuda seed and you can get that grass seed right there at Callahan's too to fill in those spots. They got everything you need, the bags of soil, the amendments, the special fertilizers. If you want to make sure that your yard and your lawn are looking like golf course condition, beautiful and plush and green and lush and healthy, our friends at Callahan's, they can help you with that. Matter of fact, they're helping me with it right now, and they can do the same for you. And if you also have that green thumb and it's the spring, you're starting to plant those vegetables, starting to plant all the different plants around the yard and in your garden beds, you can get those at Callahan's as well. They have all the seedling vegetables for your gardens, weekly variety of peppers and tomatoes and melons and other plants to make sure that you are getting that great green thumb that you want to get done in the springtime. And also, if you want to plant trees and you're starting to look to do that, they got the fruit trees for you, they got the pecan trees for you, they got everything you need there at Callahan's General Store, 501 Bastrop Highway between downtown and the airport. Remember, every day is a good day to make it a Callahan's day.
Hmm.
Back here on the Rodcast on a Thursday morning, and it is a new theme Thursday, meaning I'll pick a new theme every single week and decide what the theme will be and play music that applies to that. And this week, since it is the beginning of April, this playlist is all about fools. Every song will have Fool in it. Is our April Fool's playlist. This is some Ike and Tina Turner, A Fool in Love, but everything will be a Fool song for your playlist on a new theme Thursday. Let's get to the big fat poll of the day, 512-447-3776. And I want to continue the conversation about UT spring football.
Patrick's big fat poll of the day on the horn.
So this one, I normally try and give polls that I feel have like two or three main answers and maybe a couple more outliers. This one is a wide open. Lots of people could be on this, so I don't know what I'm going to put online yet. But let me know who you guys are. Maybe there'll be some favorites on the text line that I can then put on the poll online. But 2 weeks away from the orange and white game, I'm just trying to start thinking about who we're going to be watching in the orange and white game, which guys you're going to be looking at. We just talked about a bunch of them you're going to be looking at. But I want to name one. Which player are you most looking forward to seeing at the orange and white game? Whether it is a freshman, whether it's Ryan Wingo, whether it's Colin Simmons, whether it's a transfer, Isaiah Bond, is it a Makuba? Is it somebody like that? Is it one of your tight ends? Is it the quarterback? Do you want to see what Quinn looks like coming out of this offseason? Do you want to see what Arch looks like coming out of this offseason?
It'll probably be Arch for most people.
I think Arch will be a lot, but I think Quinn is interesting to see what Quinn looks
Quinn
like.
Quinn is interesting, but we've seen a lot of Quinn, and the expectation is that Quinn's going to be awesome. He's going to be great. You didn't get a chance to see a lot of Arch, and it's just been so much hype. So I think the spring game is actually supposed to be the game where you see a lot of Arch. You're not going to see. Why would you see a lot of Quinn? I don't need to see a lot of Quinn.
I know.
We're not be in there for two series, and I'm like, I don't need to see Quinn. I don't want to take any chances. Quinn's good. We don't need to see Quinn. Go in there, get a few completions, and you're fine. Everybody's going to want to see a lot of Arch. That's why ESPN is going to be trying to get it on some type of one of those ESPN channels. And I think that's in Longhorn fans, you know, the hype around Arch. I mean, why wouldn't there be a lot of hype around?
I get that. I'll tell you this, though. Arch is probably seventh or eighth on my list of guys I care to see.
And want to watch the actual. You're not there for the storyline.
I get
there for
the actual game. I'm asking our listeners who listen to us every morning, which we don't talk about Arch a ton. I'm asking those guys on the text line, who do you guys want to see? So is it Arch? Is it Arch heads and above shoulders above everybody else? Or is there, I get nationally, it's Arch Man. We know nationally it is. But for our guys, do you want to see the freshman? Do you want to see that? Do you want to see Jonte Cook? I think a lot of people want to see Isaiah Bond. I think a lot of guys will want to see what he does. Supposed to be a wide receiver one for Texas this year. What he does. Nye Black is an interesting guy. We don't know what he's going to look like at tight end. See his speed at tight end replacing JT Sanders, I think will be interesting. Maybe one of the freshman running backs. Maybe see how their explosivity, those guys, someone on defense maybe that you want to see. I'm curious. I think there's a lot of players that you kind of – Savion Redd is one of the ones you just want to see after the weight gain, see what he moves like.
That is true. Yeah, guys like him and Sadiq Mitchell, I'd love to see like what they play like at that kind of extreme weight that they're at. I like that question because I would go – because there are a lot of players that I want to watch, but I would go with – there are more battles that I want to watch. Like I can't wait to watch – you know, Colin Simmons go up against, you know, a young Brandon Baker, and I can't wait to watch Isaiah Bond go up against Malik Muhammad. And so there's some of those battles that I want to watch, like on the outside and on the edges that I can't wait to see. So, it is some players, but I'm more want to watch these guys because the roster is so stacked. Now I want to watch elite athletes with high upside, future NFL talent going up against future NFL talent.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I like that as well. I like to see I think Trey Moore is probably not going to play a ton in this game.
Oh, that's a good one too. Yeah.
But Trey Moore versus, if you have Trey Moore versus Kelvin Banks at any point in this game,
exactly.
You see that matchup and just go, okay, this is two future NFL players, projected NFL starters. So if you have that matchup, that'd be fun. Yeah, but that's, so throw a name out there of which player you maybe we'll go into matchups next week. We still got a couple weeks till we get there. But we'll go with players for today. Which player are you most looking forward to seeing at the orange and white game? It can be Arch Manning. I think nationally, you're right. Nationally, that'll be the question. But I think most of us kind of know where Arch is going to be. I don't know if there's a ton of surprises. So you want to see it, but you want to see the guys that you're like, well, our national championship hopes hinge on some other guys more than Arch Manning this year. So if we're worried about this season, there's other guys I'm worried about. Can these guys step up in 2024 to win that championship?
Yeah, no, it's good. I mean, now that you got the question out there, I got easily like 10.
That's what I'm saying.
I could list 10 and still be like, damn it, I missed like three guys that I really want to watch too. So that's why I'll watch the spring game like three or four times, just because I'll do exactly what you're saying. I'll go back and watch specific guys, and I'll go back and watch specific matchups with players. So good stuff there. All right, big fat poll today. Always an interesting conversation. My man Patrick throwing it out there. What player are you most looking forward to watching at the spring game? You're going to have your eye on them. Throw that out there. All right, we come back. We'll get into some mock draft discussion. The Mel Kiper mock draft. Field Yates had his latest mock draft. We'll dive into those topics on the other side. Rod's rant of the day is NFL related. It's actually quarterback related, so we'll talk about that on the other side as well. All of that and more right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Lohan. Rod Davis coming back on the horn. Welcome back to the Rodcast. It is a new theme Thursday. Sorry, I was jamming out there a little bit. I got caught up in the moment, man. I really did. I ain't going to lie to you. Jamming out there. And I hope you're jamming out, too, with my man Patrick. He's the idealionaire, not only the co-host of the show, but he's the idealionaire coming up with all the musically themed days of the weekend, much more. You'll have your horn headlines here coming up. But the new theme of the day is just about fools, since we're just coming fresh off the April Fool's holiday. And this is a dedication to fools out there, so every song will reference or have some type of reference in the title or in the chorus to fools, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Everybody's been a fool for love.
Wait, what a fool believes. Is what
there you this go. Song. Yeah. So if we're talking about fools for love or just fools in general?
Fools in general.
Fools in general. Fools
I mean, most
general,
of these right? are probably going to be about fools in love because that's more. Than...
That. You also the songs are about fools for love, but you're right. April Fool's is not necessarily about being a fool for love. It's just being foolish, period. So we appreciate my man Patrick. He's always getting creative with the musically themed days of the week. It ain't easy, folks, I assure you. every day coming up with new musically themed days of the week, but he keeps us entertained. He also keeps us informed and educated with the horn headlines. We'll have Rod's rant of the day coming up a little bit later on in this segment. We got a couple of mock drafts to get to. The Cowboys. Bringing in a couple of Longhorns, a few Longhorns for their part of their 30 visits. And they're actually they have a what they call kind of a hometown visit weekend where they bring in local prospects from the state of Texas. Then they have another weekend where they bring in kind of the national prospects, and they're having those visits right now. There are some Longhorns that will be visiting with the Dallas Cowboys. So we'll talk about whether what are the odds that the Dallas Cowboys draft another Texas Longhorn. They did recently with DeMarvion Overshown, who's expected actually to get some playing time. Was doing real good last year before he ended up getting hurt. So we'll get into that. We'll also, of course, talk more about the Stephon Diggs trade to the Houston Texans, a blockbuster trade. It's a doozy. And we talked about yesterday the Nick Caserio, the Nick Caserio story from yesterday was that he was clearing cap space because he was going to make a move. He cleared about $32 million in cap space, and now we know why, because they were bringing in Stephon Diggs. They wanted to make a move, and it is a hell of a splash. So we'll get back to that conversation, too. We also will get a bit tomorrow. So next segment, we'll get into something that I wanted to talk about a little bit. The Caitlin Clark phenomenon is also having an impact. We talked about it was in the rumor mill that she was going to be involved in All-Star Weekend whenever she was drafted into the WNBA. She'll be drafted number one overall. Well, Shams Charania has already confirmed that the NBA is considering some type of Caitlin Clark event at the All-Star game. So that didn't take long at all. It started out as a rumor on social media and quickly caught enough fire to at least have one of the NBA insiders talk to someone on the inside about what the NBA plans to do about capitalizing on the Caitlin Clark phenomenon. So we'll get to that coming up next segment. Also, Wimby is getting some love for Defensive Player of the Year. Finally, I was going to say I was one of the first ones on the bandwagon saying Wimby should win Defensive Player of the Year. And I was pretty much, mocked and ridiculed and laughed at on these airways and other airways because, Patrick, I said from day one, I said he's going to walk into the NBA and possibly be one of the, if not the best defender in the NBA when he walks in.
Yeah.
And people were like, you're crazy. And I was like, man, I don't think y'all have really seen this dude move and have the length and the range. The NBA's never really seen anything like it. And slowly but surely now, you're starting to have NBA players and some of the NBA insiders. They're not necessarily on that bandwagon, but if he wins Defensive Player of the Year in his first year, essentially that's what the NBA has declared, that he's the best defender in the NBA in his rookie year. Draymond Green now will play the audio. He's now on the bandwagon. I don't know if Brian Windhorst is officially on the bandwagon, but he did say that he's got to reconsider his vote. He said he had initially thought it was going to be Rudy Gobert for him, but he's going to reconsider. I believe he's reconsidering watching Wimby down the stretch here. I don't know if he's got enough time to change everybody's opinion, but it's going to be really interesting to see how many people actually vote for Wimby. I know the Spurs are bad, but vote for Wimby for Defensive Player of the Year because now it is not an asinine, crazy, radical thought that it was when I first jumped on that bandwagon to start the season. Now it's more realistic for people. They're starting to see it.
No, and I'll wait till we talk about next segment. But there are some reasons why people did not believe it that I can get into, and there's some reasons why earlier in the season it was not as much of a thought as it is now. But I'm with you. But I'm also part of, you say there wasn't a lot of people. Whatever the population of San Antonio and you, that was who was.
That is true. You're right. I wasn't sure. You're right. The Spurs fans, they would have believed anything I said. You know, he can be MVP in this first year. Yes, we agree.
Is there an award higher than MVP?
Yes. Seriously. No, you're right about that. But I'm talking about nationally. I just want to throw out there that I've been pounding on the table for it for the entire season. I'm glad now it's starting to get some substantive support from those on the inside. So we'll get into that next segment, talk some NBA, and talk a little hoops and talk some basketball. All right, let's start with our Horn headlines, and then we'll dive into the Cowboys, who are hosting a lot of players, including some Longhorns. We'll also get into this. We'll get back to the Stephon Diggs story a little bit too. Of course, that's a blockbuster trade. We'll get into some of the other headlines of the day with the Horn headline from my man Patrick Davis.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball begins their weekend series with BYU at Dishwalk Field tonight. Texas will stick with the rotation of LeBaron Johnson Jr., Ace Whitehead, and Max Grubbs for starting pitching. And the current league leaders in home runs, Jalen Flores and Max Belue, will hope to keep their hot bats alive against a BYU team that is at the bottom of the Big 12 standings. The Houston Texans agreed to a blockbuster trade yesterday, sending a 2025 second-round pick to the Buffalo Bills for wide receiver Stephon Diggs and two late-round draft picks. This is the latest move by the Texans after signing multiple big-name defensive free agents and trading for running back Joe Mixon earlier this offseason. With the NBA regular season winding down, the Houston Rockets play a must-win game tonight against the Golden State Warriors. Houston is currently three games out of the 10 seed and play-in tournament behind Golden State. And the Mavericks will be in action against the Hawks, looking to make up ground on a Clippers team who will have their hands full facing the Denver Nuggets. And in the NBA, the Astros and Rangers are off today as the Rangers won their second series of the season against the Rays after a 4-1 victory yesterday, with Eovaldi pitching seven solid innings. And the Astros got the win over the Blue Jays 8-0, powered by Yordan Alvarez's two home runs. The two teams will meet each other for the first time this season, starting Friday in Arlington. And that is your Horn headlines.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the Horn headlines. We'll have your rant of the day coming up here a little bit later on. But I want to get to a couple of these mock drafts. And, Patrick, you also pulled some audio of Mel Kiper talking about Xavier Worthy and his draft prospects. But Mel Kiper's latest mock draft, which came out about a week ago. So it's still actually less than a week ago. I got it here as couple of days ago, but Mel Kiper's latest mock draft, he's got Byron Murphy as the first Longhorn off the board, going 19 to the Rams, which makes a lot of sense because the Rams obviously lost Aaron Donald when he retired. He's got Xavier Worthy going to the Bucks at 26. I'll admit, I haven't seen that yet. That's the first time I've seen man, and maybe Xavier Worthy or A.D. Mitchell going to the Bucks at 26. So maybe he's hearing something there. And he's got A.D. Mitchell going 32nd overall to the Kansas City Chiefs with the last pick in the first round. I will say this, though. There's been a lot of buzz now because of the Stephon Diggs trade, which I said we talked a lot about it in the first hour. We'll get back to that conversation. But because of where the Bills are, and I think it's my man Matt Miller who brought this up, because of where the Bills are drafting at 28, the receivers that they're going to be considering, because everybody believes they're going to draft the receiver now because they traded Stephon Diggs, they're going to draft the receiver.
And lost Gabe Davis in free agency.
And lost Gabe Davis in free agency. Thank you. So it seems to be a foregone conclusion. They're going receiver in the first round. They could surprise people, but everybody believes that. If they're going receiver, the receivers that they're going to be considering at that time that will still be available, and this is what Matt Miller said in NFL Draft Scout, he says, wide receiver names to know in Buffalo, Brian Thomas Jr., Adonai Mitchell, Xavier Worthy, Ladd McConkey, Xavier Leggett, who also could be available at that time. And then he also goes on to say Thomas likely off the board at 28 overall, which brings it to four receivers, and two of those are Texas Longhorns. So there is also a really good chance that the Buffalo Bills are looking at two of the Texas receivers, or those two Texas receivers at that spot at 28. So that's the sweet spot for Texas, is right around that 28 spot, I guess 26, too, if you're looking at where Mel Kiper is mocking the Longhorns, mocking Xavier Worthy to the Bucs at 26. And then even all the way to 32 with the Kansas City Chiefs, who also are in the market for a receiver. Those are good places to land because you've got really good franchise quarterbacks in those spots. Well, I don't know if Baker's considered a franchise quarterback, but he's coming off his best year. So good places for those guys to land. But I think that's going to be the sweet spot for him based on the latest mocks, and then kind of based on now the latest blockbuster news and the domino effect of that Stephon Diggs trade.
It is. And I will say, I'll just throw in this tidbit that I think Buffalo, if they wanted to find a really good fit for a Buffalo team, then I would at least look at Jordan Whittington as a guy who could get really cheap, maybe undrafted, maybe late round, but also is, when we say the best blocking wide receiver in the draft, for a guy who likes to run the ball and Josh Allen, maybe someone who can, you know, can get out on the outside and be a little outlet for you. And if Josh Allen runs, could block, just say I'd look at him. If I was Buffalo, I'd look at him. If I was Baltimore, if I had a mobile quarterback, I would look at Jordan Whittington. Let me put it that way. I would say, let me go get a guy who I feel can help protect my quarterback, even when I'm not throwing to him. And for Buffalo now, when you don't have a lot of wide receivers, you know, if you have room in that wide receiver room, then maybe I at least take a look at him for a late round pick or an undrafted free agent. I would at least take a look. But yeah, it's, you're seeing more and more, even guys that I've seen. We'll play the clip of Mel Kiper, but Field Yates was also on that clip, and he was saying he didn't have Xavier Worthy as high. And in his latest mock draft, he has Xavier Worthy going to Buffalo. So he even has Xavier Worthy going in the first round and going in that sweet spot of what you're talking about. And that's from a guy who says he did not have Xavier Worthy as high on his big board. So I think more and more people are getting on the bandwagon that they're seeing that teams are going to look at wide receiver. They're probably hearing more and more teams talking about going wide receiver in that first round, that people want to get them. They feel that there's other teams that are looking for that position right now. So you want to get in the first round. Somebody you thought may you be able to get in the second round, you may just go ahead and go for in the first. And that would be good news for Texas, because that's how you get both your guys drafted and have three first round picks.
Yeah, you're right. That Field Yates mock draft, a two round, has Xavier Worthy going to Buffalo at 28, AD Mitchell going to the Chargers.
Yes, in a trade where
23 is a trade. Yes,
the Chargers trade out of that five spots, and then they get down. They get down. They get what the Texans pick would have been, because Minnesota trades up to the fives.
And that makes sense, right? They traded Keenan Allen, so they no longer have Keenan Allen. Mike Williams is gone there.
Yeah,
they have Quentin Johnston, who then I am saying he's a bust, but he was an underwhelming rookie for them, and that's kind of where they're. Where their wide receiving core starts, building around Quentin Johnston. I can see them deciding, yeah, hey, we made a mistake with him. Let's go get us a true, what we think is it maybe the potential and upside to be a number one wide receiver. In that Field Yates draft, the two-round mock draft, he also has Jonathan Brooks going to the Cowboys.
Yes.
He's got Jay Brooks going to the Cowboys in the second round, though. In the second round, he's got him going to the Cowboys.
Which is a very popular pick now.
NFL Live even had it earlier this week. They were doing most likely picks. I see most compatible picks for teams, and they had Jonathan Brooks going to the Cowboys, not in the first round, but in the second round, that would be the pick. And we know Jerry and the Cowboys like to take some chances in the second round, and I don't know how much of a risky pick Jonathan Brooks would be, because I think he's going to fully recover and be great. But the Cowboys have more inside information on Jonathan Brooks' surgery, recovery, and rehab, because their surgeon, their team surgeon, is the one that performed the surgery. So, and the Cowboys have a lot of trust in their training staff. So maybe the Cowboys are, maybe everybody's right about that. Maybe it just makes too much, and they need a running back.
Yeah.
It just makes too much damn sense for the Cowboys. Speaking of the Cowboys, they had their 30 prospects visits. They hosted their 30 prospects for visits recently at the Star this week. And on that list, you did have three Longhorns represented on that list, Jay Brooks being one of them, but also JT Sanders and Byron Murphy, reported by Ian Rappaport, all were visitors for the local talented kind of prospects they brought in during their 30 prospect visits. So those were among the three. Maybe Jay Brooks or JT Sanders. I don't think it's very likely for the Cowboys. Byron Murphy, not really. Well, maybe Byron Murphy could drop there. I mean, he's right now mocked to be drafted anywhere in the mid to late teens. So yeah, I guess if teams are, there's a run on other positions, or if they draft the other D tackle, the Illinois D tackle, his name escapes me right now. They draft him ahead of Byron Murphy, and then they go pass rushers ahead of him, maybe corners ahead of him, then he could drop down. But for the most part, I've already seen him mid to late teens. If he drops down to the 20 something, Cowboys did just invest a first round pick in a D tackle in Mozzie Smith. I don't think they do it back to back years with Byron Murphy, but anything could happen.
Yeah, I mean, and you've got so many other needs. It's hard to It's hard to not draft an O-lineman in that first round for the Cowboys. You know, you do need a defensive tackle too, but at the same point, it's just hard to pretend that you're going to be able to get two starting offensive linemen if you said we're going to take Byron Murphy and then we still have to take a running back somewhere in this first, in the second, third round, and we have to get two starting offensive linemen in there, and we probably need some help at linebacker too. I don't know if you can afford to do that there, but possibly. Who knows?
Yeah. No, they got a lot of holes to fill, and I'm with you. Every 95% of the mocks that I've seen have the Cowboys in that first round taking an offensive lineman, which is, I think, what they need most. That's a dire need for them. They need a center, and they also need a tackle. So I'm pretty much – I think that's where they'll go. They could go guard because they can always move – Tyler Smith around. That's the beauty of what Tyler Smith, provides. He provides versatility. He can play tackle. He can play guard. So whatever best talent available at the offensive line position falls to you, you can just take that value. If it's the best interior offensive lineman on the board, take them. If it's the best tackle on the board, take them. You can go. I don't know if there'll be a center that they value that high, but who knows? I mean, I'm not sure who the best center in the NFL draft is. I got to go back and do some research.
No, and I think they think they can probably find one a little bit later too. I mean, Biotis, you always can. Biotis was a fourth round pick, I believe. So I think they feel they can find somebody a little bit later. But yeah, I mean, I if I remember correctly, even in the clip last year of when they showed the war room of the Cowboys and they drafted Mozzie Smith, there was the conversation, do we go O-lineman? Cowboys just like drafting O-lineman early in drafts.
It is. I mean, it's a smart move. I mean, they've actually hit on more of those O linemen that they've been drafting in the first round than missed on them. So the Cowboys are actually one of the better first round drafting teams in the NFL. You found some Mel Kiper sound on Xavier Worthy.
Yes.
Of him talking about X-Men that I actually want to hear, because I don't think I've heard this either. I know he likes Xavier Worthy and A.D. Mitchell. I remember hearing him say on NFL Live, I believe he was on, and they asked him, Mel, what receivers are the most underrated in this really deep wide receiver class? And he said, the Texas guys are underrated. This was before the combine. He said, the Texas guys are underrated. And he went on about X-Man speed and then talked about AD Mitchell. So I know he likes the Texas receivers. I wonder if he likes them even more or maybe even less post combine.
Well, here's Mel Kiper. He was talking, I believe it's called NFL draft or NFL live. It was some NFL take with Field Yates. They were doing a show talking about NFL mock drafts. Here's Mel Kiper.
Where does he rank on your wide receiver big board?
I think he will be either right where Brian Thomas Jr. from LSU is or slightly ahead of Brian Thomas Jr. After we talk about that big three field, okay, of Marvin Harrison Jr., Malik Nabers, and Romo Odunze, he could be right in the mix as that next guy. You can't teach your coach the speed. When you have a guy like this, can he control his speed? He can control it. Is he consistent catching the football? Yes, for the most part, he is. You had the broken hand, and he had some drops 2 years ago with that late in the year. When he's healthy, he is a guy, is a fear factor player. 4.21 speed translates to the field. You can get him on jet sweeps, reverses, get him in space, move him around, and he is a nightmare to try to corral in the open field. So for me, the 165 in terms of this is his weight. Yes. Is it a concern? Would you like him to do 175, 180? Yeah. Okay. But what you have here is a dynamic player who is a guy who will give you a great attitude, great approach. He is tough. I watched this kid on tape, and what I like, feel, is when a guy doesn't shy away from contact. Say, you wish he would a little bit protect that body at 165, but he's a tough kid. We know how tough Malik Nabers is, right? Xavier Worthy's right behind him. So I love the kid. I mean, people will knock him for being 165, fine. I think you make a strong argument after the big three. He's next in line. He also has the return ability. You are going to get production with this kid, and you can utilize him in a lot of different ways.
Wow. I guess he likes him even more. I don't know if he had him. He's basically saying he's the fourth best wide receiver in this draft class. I'm not sure he had him that high when I heard him say that he really likes those Texas wide receivers. So he must have moved them up on his big board. At least Xavier Worthy, he moved him
yes.
up.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. That's why I pulled that audio, is because Mel Kiper, that is probably one of the highest praises you will hear for Xavier Worthy, basically saying, I don't care that he's 165. He plays like he's bigger than 165, and he is able to – that the speed is not an illusion, that it's just a 40 time, because they do have those clocks now, and they do have the trackers on the players now, that they're able to judge him in-game, and he has that. He has the in-game speed. He has the ability to change speeds, all of those pieces. I thought it was a really good breakdown of what he could offer to a team. And then you add in, too, the returns now, that even if he's not your, you know, even if you have a couple other wide receivers and you're bringing him up, the ability to use him in returns adds even more value to him.
Yep. No, I have come to the conclusion, I believe he is an outlier. I know the numbers say someone as slight and as light as him is not going to be a really productive wide receiver in the NFL. You go look at the wide receivers at the combine in terms of body mass index who have been as light as him. And really the only receiver that has a frame like him that's been able to be really productive in the NFL and have basically 1,000-yard seasons has been DeSean Jackson and Devontae Smith. Those are really the only two that have been as slight as him, as skinny, I should say, right, as those guys are, and being able to translate that to the NFL. And even the speed demons that have been really elite, elite world-class speedsters at the combine and set, you know, records at the combine running the 40, and you're going to take the top 25 fastest receivers at the combine, and only one of them is a 1,000-yard receiver, and that's Santana Moss. The speed doesn't always translate to being a really good receiver. It's just it's a great trait to combine with others that'll help you become a really good receiver and a refined route runner and create separation, but it's not the end-all, be-all. And I think for Xavier Worthy, I think he can be the outlier in both of those instances. A guy who is as small as he is, who can be productive in the NFL. Haven't seen a lot of examples of that. You know, the best two, like I said, are Devontae Smith and DeSean Jackson. And then seeing a guy who has world-class speed, but the speed does not define his game. It's just part of his game. It is that define him as a player. It's just part of his elite traits and his athletic profile as a player. That's what Mel Kiper's saying. Usually when players are that fast, the speed defines them. That's all they are.
Yeah.
They're speedsters and track guys trying to play football. Xavier Worthy is a football player who happens to have world-class speed. And that's what Mel Kiper's saying. That makes him a bit of an outlier.
Yeah, and I know, and it's also, you throw in the fact that I think when people see him as slight, they may see him as shorter, but he's 6'1". So he is a guy that has at least a little bit of height on him as well to be able to go up and get balls. So the slight is a problem, but like Devontae Smith, he's about the same height as Devontae Smith. DeSean Jackson was only 5'10". So there is a little bit of difference where, you know, he can go up and get balls a little bit differently than some other guys could as well. If you're playing against a DB and DB heights are usually under 6 foot, then it gives him a little edge in that sense, where instead of being, well, he's small, he's a small overall guy, like Tank Dell's a little bit smaller overall, that Xavier Worthy still has that little bit of height. So if you go speed, he's not undersized height wise, he's undersized weight wise. I think there's a lot of positives, but I think there's so many ways to weaponize him that the right coach will find him in that early rounds. And the only reason he doesn't go in that early in the first round is if there's not a run on wide receivers and wide receivers start to slip, and then, you know, people feel confident they can get their guy, that they, if there's a group of five or six, you mentioned the group of four or five guys, and if those four guys are still available, late first round, then no one's going to take a wide receiver because you'll just wait until he gets the second round.
Yeah, and I think right now Xavier Worthy's trending ahead of A.D. Mitchell. That's not only with Mel Kiper. I think a lot of mock drafts now have Xavier Worthy going ahead of A.D. Mitchell. I think they're right there and they're together, though. It's a preference thing. If you like speed, you'll probably take Xavier Worthy. If you're a fan of body control and size, then you'll most likely take an A.D. Mitchell. All right, so good conversation there. I know we missed Ross Rand today. We'll get into that next segment along with some hoops discussion. We'll talk about Caitlin Clark already inspiring the NBA and giving them marketing ideas. We'll also get into the Wimby Defensive Player of the Year conversation. There are some NBA players now on my bandwagon that I started. I'm going to give myself credit because I said he could win Defensive Player of the Year even before he ever even played in the NBA. I said it's possible he could do it in his first year. So I'm going to take credit for that. And we'll also get into this very strange story about, is it DJ Burns?
Yes, DJ Burns.
DJ Burns is getting a lot of attention, not only from basketball fans, and I'm sure he's got aspirations to play in the NBA, but if the NBA doesn't work out for DJ Burns, he may have an alternative. He may have another route to become a pro athlete, and this is real. I thought it was an April Fool's joke. That's why I didn't hit it a couple of days ago. I saw this story a couple of days ago, and I was like, April Fool, I ain't falling for it. No. I'm not an idiot. And now the story is still out there, and actually it's gained some legs. So we'll get into that on the other side, too. Talk some hoops, all that more when we return. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming right back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Aside from the traffic, we all love this city. And even with the traffic, it's still a great city. That's why people keep moving to Austin, making the traffic even worse. But also just proving that it's such a great place to live. And as the city continues to grow and thrive, so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482 and many of the iconic landmarks you may be driving by right now since you're sitting in traffic were actually built and constructed and created by the skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local 482. Take, for instance, the Pennybacker Bridge, DKR Stadium, just to name a couple. And the folks over at Ironworkers Local 42 right now are constructing another iconic landmark here in Central Texas. They're engaging in a huge project right here, and they need your help. They're hiring over 3,000 people for project right here in Central Texas, and they're offering competitive wages, competitive benefits, a pension plan. They even offer training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program, which means and if you don't have the skills, as long as you have the work ethic, as long as you have the want to, and as long as you are eager, they can provide you with the skills so that you can become a member of this prestigious organization, Ironworkers Local Union 482. So right now it's a perfect time if you're thinking about a new employee opportunity, or maybe you want something a little bit more exciting, or maybe you want a new challenge, maybe you want to feel valued by your employer, maybe you want a refreshing career change. Whatever the reason, right now is a perfect time for you to look up the opportunities available at Ironworkers Local Union 482. Just so go online and you can inquire about all the numerous positions and all the benefits, the competitive wages, the pension plan, even the apprenticeship program. You can go online today at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. I'll be quick here with Rod's rant of the day. We'll go over it in more detail when we have our next Rod rant coming up later on the show. But I want to talk about leap quarterbacks. It seems like since 2017, every year we have another quarterback, a young quarterback in there, maybe their second, around their second or third year, they just take a huge leap, an exponential leap in improvement, and they ascend, you know, to the into a conversation of being maybe they can be an elite quarterback in the league, right? Or one of the top 10 quarterbacks in the NFL. Jared Goff took that leap in 2017 with the Rams. 2018, Patrick Mahomes became Patrick Mahomes, right? That was in his second year. Jared Goff was in his second year. Lamar Jackson, in his second year in 2019, took that leap. Josh Allen in his third year in 2020 was that guy. In 2021, a young Joe Burrow, second year Joe Burrow, had a great season. In 2022, it was Jalen Hurts, right? And you can say Trevor Lawrence if you want to. You can even throw out Tua, because Tua had that leap there, and he was a third year guy. I think for Hurts, it was his third year. Trevor Lawrence, it was his second year, if I'm not mistaken, there. And then 2023 was Jordan Love, right? Jordan Love was that young quarterback in his third year early on in his development that took that leap forward and now, you know, ascended to a different conversation, ascended into a different conversation as potential one of the better quarterbacks in the league. And I don't know who's going to be in 2024 because it was supposed to be CJ Stroud, because CJ Stroud already did it, though. He did it in his rookie year. You're supposed to do it in your second or third year. You did it in his rookie year somewhere where it can be CJ Stroud. He's already considered a top 10 quarterback after his rookie season by a lot of folks. So who is he going to be to take that leap forward in their second or third year? And some people would say it's Brock Purdy. Brock Purdy already pretty much took that leap as well. Like many guys already played in the Super Bowl. So he already took the leap. So he's already one of those guys. So if I'm betting on two players who haven't had the leap yet as a quarterback, who will, Anthony Richardson's another is a guy to consider as a Texans fan. I'm hoping that's not the case, but he's someone to consider. Or Will Levis is someone to consider that he could take it to another level as well. Or Justin Fields with the Pittsburgh Steelers. So those are my three candidates who could be leap quarterbacks. I don't know if there are a lot of candidates, though, because C.J. Stroud pretty much screwed up the cycle because he was so ahead of schedule as a prodigy. I don't know if there is it could be Bryce Young. It could be Bryce Young.
Yeah, Bryce Young. That was the one I would say. He's technically not a bust yet. But it's that Carolina team does not seem like it gave him a lot of help this offseason.
That's kind of what I'm thinking.
Get him over the hump, where even if he has a good season, it's still not going to be, wow, Bryce Young's this great top 10 quarterback. Like, to be and by the way, if they win 9 games, he's the top 10 quarterback. But
I don't see that happening, but I'm with you. It would take so much elite play from him to lift the play of others around him in a supporting cast.
That's what I'm saying. It feels like the odds are stacked against him. So he may be a guy in year 3 next year. If they were to build a little bit this year and then build some more next year, then you could say maybe a year 3 Bryce Young could go in that conversation. But year 2, I don't see it happening.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I don't see. That's why I didn't really listen. But I can see Anthony Richardson doing. I can see Justin Fields, new system, new talent, new coaching, new regime. I can see him make a leap like that too. Okay, we'll get back to that. And I know I want to get into that a little bit more detail. But every year, think about the leap quarterback. There's been one. Who is he going to be in 2024? Okay, well, speaking of leaps, Wimby has taken a huge leap forward in his development. We played the sound of Brian Windhorst earlier this week saying Wimby's ahead of schedule, which means, hey, man, the Spurs may be ahead of schedule in this rebuild. He's starting to turn some heads, and I've been on the record saying I think he could win Defensive Player of the Year in his first year. I got mocked, ridiculed, and laughed at, but now it's actually becoming a serious topic of conversation. And one of the best defenders in the NBA, Draymond Green, now is on the bandwagon with me. Here's Draymond Green talking about Wimby for Defensive Player of the Year.
By the way, I know I said on here a little while back, Wimby shouldn't be the Defensive Player of the Year, and I lied. Wimby should be the Defensive Player of the Year because he is that amazing defensively. The way he impacts the game on the defensive end, whether it's off the ball, on the ball, it's a problem. When you start driving to the hole and like guys may have a layup, maybe not, and they just turn out and go the other way, that's a problem. And that's a block shot in a sense, you know, and no one will account for that. It's like a screen. You go set it in a screen, no one's going to give you an assist, but the guy's wide open to knock a shot down. You drive into the lane and get a layup and you see Wimby and you just go the other way, that's a block shot. I don't know what lab he was created in, but I need to go create me a son in that lab because dude is unbelievable.
All right, there you go. All right, what say you, Patrick? It's now I got Draymond Green is on the bandwagon. So that's a fit. Now I got somebody official on the defense, Wimby for defensive player of the year. What say you? I love what he said about basically deterrent shots that basically he will get players to just turn around. And I've seen that before. I've actually seen that watching Wimby play.
Spurs fans and Spurs people are starting to cut up those highlights because they're not stats. And they were like, there needs to be a stat for the times. There was a fast break where a guy turned around, threw the ball to another guy. He drove in and then turned around and passed the ball back out. And they never even really got closer. Just like, what's the point? He's standing there. It's done. It's like, first of all, I will say I'm with you, but I've also been on the, Wimby bandwagon. You know, on Ball Don't Lie. I was talking about Wimby a year before they even got drafted.
Yes, very true. Yeah, no
Spurs
doubt,
need
no
to
doubt.
Suck to get him.
Yes. What was your slogan?
Winless for Wembanyama.
Winless for Wembanyama. Yeah. Yes, that was I remember you championing that for like a whole year. Yeah.
So we had that, but I think early in the year, and so some of the things that were people had questions about was, can he defend against bigger guys? Are guys like Jokic going to come in, or just even like a Valanciunas or a Steven Adams or guys like that who are maybe not even star players but are bigger guys? Alperen Şengün had a good game against him. Embiid had a good game against him. Those guys if he gets put in situations where he's going to get back down, and can he just not defend a certain type of player? Well, that takes you kind of further off the Defensive Player of the Year board, because if there's certain types of players that can just dominate you, then you can have that. That was earlier in the year. That was happening more and more. And I think they've started to figure out ways around that more. I think he's started to figure out how to play it as he's grown into himself. He's figured out the way of, look, you can back up as close as you want to this basket. You still can't turn around and get elevation while you're connected to me to get over my hands. Yeah. So all I have to do is basically stand straight up and down with my hands right in front of the basket. And it still makes this an extremely hard shot. And so I think he's found better and better ways to do that. They've been able to use Sochan as a guy to use some body, have him on the weak side to help out so he can come over and get some blocks. And basically, even if you think you made a great move on Sochan, you are now turning around to see the 7'5" guy trying to block your shot. The ball, you didn't expect people to have body control, even with his size, the body control you expected early in the season. And he was picking up more fouls early in the season to start to control the foul trouble. Because if you're constantly playing against big guys and constantly banging the post, that those hands will come down a little bit more. When you're trying to block shots, you will make too much contact. But he's being able to get a little separation because of his size and athleticism and still be able to get those blocks. So there's been pieces of it throughout the season that he's improved against. But I think early in the season, when he was playing a 3-4 kind of hybrid and they weren't playing him at that 5 position, he wasn't Defensive Player of the Year. He wasn't Rookie of the Year. Because that wasn't where he really should have been. It wasn't the best lineup of the Spurs on the court. It messed up the spacing defensively and offensively with Zach Collins on the court and Jeremy Sochan, and it just didn't work. So that was part of the reason why early in the season, if you watch the Spurs, you said, well, he's not the best because we don't even know what he is. And in the second half of the season, post All-Star break, when they've said he is a 5, this is what we're doing, there is a game plan for the Spurs right now. He has just looked like a much different player defensively. He's in better position. He knows what his role is defensively, and everyone else on the team knows what their role is now. And so it just changed everything dramatically defensively. Now the issue is when he walks off the court, nobody knows what their role is anymore, and that defense starts to suffer immensely. But while he's on the court, everybody knows what they're doing. And the first half of the season, so the conversations changed. Because, again, Chet Holmgren was a Rookie of the Year for at least a third of the season. He was just playing better. He was on a better team. Everything was going his way. By the time he got to the All-Star break, the momentum was shifting that Wimby was starting to come into it, and now it's not a discussion. Wimby is Rookie of the Year. And so that conversation had to shift in the second half of the season. But that was not only Wimby coming into his own, realizing what the league is. You know, he did not play college ball. He played overseas, which is a completely different game than playing which college ball is different than pros too. But over there, just the way he was being played, he didn't even play a ton of minutes. That's one of the reasons he left the Tony Parker team, was because he was not going to play a ton of minutes. And he wanted to get more time on the court. He had minutes restrictions early in the season because of his ankle injuries. There was all these pieces that meant early in the season, he wasn't defensive player of the year. But going into later and how dominant he's been and the ground he made up statistically, where it's just so hard to ignore what he has become. I think that if you look at it all, just that from the second half of the season on, he's hands down the defensive player of the year. The question of why he may not get the votes is because the Spurs record is bad and because the first half of the season was questionable.
That's a great breakdown. And to your point, Brian Windhorst said, I understand. He's talking about Rudy Gobert and Wimby for Defensive Player of the Year. I understand Rudy is going to win Defensive Player of the Year, but my vote hasn't been decided. That's what I'm saying. Are we sure? And I'm saying I'm not sure. By the way, he had 9 blocks tonight against the Nuggets. So Brian Windhorst saying, I ain't sure. What I'm watching right now, because this is got it, like you kind of watches every game, and he's like, nah, I'm not sure anymore that he ain't Defensive Player of the Year. He might be. And that's why I think Draymond Green said earlier this year, to your point, he's not Defensive Player of the Year. And now he's walking that back and saying, yes, he is Defensive Player of the Year, because like you pointed out, he knows his role now. Yeah. Now everybody else knows what his role is defensively, and he is thriving in that role, which has changed. So that's a good point. All right. I wanted to get to some other audio. We'll say that. We'll table that. The DJ Burns, the Peter Schrager audio about DJ Burns, the NC State big man inside, and also the wanted to get some audio about Sham Sharania talking about Caitlin Clark and how the NBA already has their mind set on marketing Caitlin Clark, doing some cross promotion with Caitlin Clark, who is now the biggest phenomenon right now in college sports. So we'll get to that. But on the other side, we got what the facts, what the stats. We'll come back right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming back on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. If you're sitting in traffic right now, you're probably in a bad mood. You'd be in a better mood if you were sitting in traffic in a car that you enjoyed. See, a lot of you out there maybe sitting in a car that you no longer enjoy. It doesn't fit your lifestyle anymore. Maybe you need a bigger car. Maybe you need something newer. Maybe your car is run down, giving you a lot of problems. If you're in the market for a new car, you need to reach out to my friends over at Apple Leasing. Apple Leasing has the ability to put you in any make or model vehicle that you want. The professionals over at Apple Leasing can help you get the price you want, the payment you want on the car that you want. And all it takes is one simple phone call from you or a click on Apple Leasing's website, and you'll get a quote on any make or model vehicle that you want. They can even give you an estimate on the value of your trade-in right over the phone. They like to make the process simple. That's why they call their lease a simple interest easy lease, because it's simple and easy. It's going to give you flexibility, which is going to give you more possibilities and options to help you find the vehicle that fits you best, but more importantly, the vehicle that fits your budget best. Everything seems overpriced these days. That's why leasing makes more sense than ever. You're only paying for the part of the car you're actually using. My friends at Apple Leasing, they know that your time is valuable, so they're going to save you time and also save you money. And that's what they're going to do and find you tremendous value. So what are you waiting for? Give them a call, 512-346-9977, 512-346-9977, or visit appleleasing.com. That's appleleasing.com. All right, a couple of Wimby stats and then a couple of NBA stats for you. Victor Wembanyama just reached 1,400 points and 700 rebounds this season. Only two rookies in NBA history have reached 1,400 points, 700 rebounds, 200 assists, and 200 blocks. Those two rookies are Victor Wembanyama, of course, and Tim Duncan. Freaking Spurs fans. Victor Wembanyama also now the fourth player in NBA history, not just rookies, fourth player in NBA history, period, to have seven or more games of 20-plus points, 5-plus assists, and 5-plus blocks in a single season. The only other three, David Robinson, the Admiral, Hakeem, the Dream, Olajuwon, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. So, pretty damn good company to be in. I mean, this dude was flirting with a quadruple double tonight against Denver, right?
Yeah, against the defending world champs. Yeah,
9 blocks, 8 assists, 15 rebounds. 20. He was basically 2 assists and 1 block away from a quadruple double. He's gonna get that. Honestly, I think he'll get it in his first 2 years. I think he'll get it.
Yeah,
by the end of next season, he'll have a quadruple double.
Yeah, I think that's definitely coming at a point. The question is, does he do like Akeem and get multiple of them? Does he like throughout his career? How many does he get? That's just this defining question, weird stat of this is the best player to ever do this. Because if you once you get into that group of people that you're naming and where it's Tim Duncan's and Hakeem Olajuwon, it's just that's an elite level. And the reality of why rookies don't get blocks like that, because even players who are good at blocking, you don't normally get the benefit of the calls for most of these guys. So you're gonna get valuable, and you normally don't have the body control and know how to play within the rules like those guys.
What you call them, the daddy blocks, or what they call?
They're dad blocks.
The dad blocks. That's why he doesn't get called for fouls, because the ref's like, dude, look how humiliating that is. He just blocked. He didn't even jump. He just blocks you with just his length, just putting his arms up.
That's the question I want to see. Can someone pull up that stat of who has the most blocks with both feet on the ground?
Freaky Wimby stats, right? There you go. That's a freaky Wimby stat. He's definitely got the league record is. He's got that for dad blocks. Okay, real quick. The Celtics have been dominant this year. We haven't talked about it enough, but how about this? If you go look at it, the Celtics right now in largest gaps in net rating, all right, in the NBA, the leaders in net rating right now, the difference for the Celtics, 4.2 difference in net rating. By the way, and that's between them and the next best team. So their net rating is the leader in net rating, 11.6. The Thunder is the next closest, second place at 7.4, so a 4.2 difference. That would be the fourth largest gap in net rating from first to second place in NBA history. The other three teams ahead of them, 1971 Bucks, 1996 Bulls, 1962 Celtics, all won the title. The team behind them, 2017 Warriors, 1965 Celtics, 1970 Knicks, 1960 Celtics, also all won the title. So all the teams there in the top eight and largest gaps in net rating from first to second place all won the title. They're fourth all time in NBA history, and everybody ahead of them and behind them won the NBA title.
I don't know. We will see. That Celtics team, I still don't know if they're a regular season team or a playoff team. We just don't know yet. But I don't know who in the East is going to knock them off either. I don't know if there's any. I feel like they got a pretty easy path to the finals.
If they don't get to the finals, it is one of the biggest disappointments in NBA history, actually.
Because if they can't beat this Philly and they can't beat Milwaukee, they can't beat Cleveland. Come on.
Exactly. The Celtics now have a plus 11.7 point differential on the season. And how about this? If you go look at the teams ahead of them in NBA history, because they're fourth in NBA history right now in point differential at 11.7. The Lakers in 71-72, 12.2. The Bucks in 70-71, 12.2. The 95-96 Bulls, 12.2. All champions. The team behind this Celtics team, 2016-17 Warriors, champions. So the top five teams in point differential in NBA history are all champions, and the Celtics are the fourth team. So four out of the five, I would say the Celtics are the fourth team there. They're running. They're just mollywopping everybody right now. They play You're right. Does it translate to the playoffs? There you go. What the facts, what the stats, a little NBA news notes and nuggets there. We come back. Biggest story of the day, the blockbuster trade, sending Stefon Diggs to the Houston Texans. We'll talk about it. We'll examine it from every angle. We'll slap it up, flip it, and rub it down right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming back on the horn. Welcome back to the Rodcast. It is a new theme Thursday edition of the Rodcast. That's with my co-host, the Idillionaire Patrick Davis. He comes up with a new theme, and all of the songs will actually have something to do with that theme, or they'll mention that theme, or they'll be titled with something that relates to that theme. And the new theme for today is about fools, because we just celebrated April Fool's Day. So all the songs reference fools, or they actually have a chorus that talks about fools, not just fools in love, fools of any kind. So
yeah, like this isn't passion. Fools in love.
What is this?
This fools is Won't Get Fooled Again.
Time. Won't Get Fooled Again. I like that. Who sings this?
The Who.
The Who?
The Who.
There you go. I'm always always educated. I always come away a little bit wiser about different music genres after the musically themed days of the week. So I want to thank my man Patrick for that. Also, thank Patrick for the big fat poll of the day, which is up. You can go check out the big fat poll of the day. Specs, the text line, actually a lot of conversation going on there. 512-447-3776. Patrick, let the people know what the big fat poll of the day is about.
Big fat poll of the day today. Which player are you most looking forward to seeing at the orange and white game? We know nationally that will be Arch Manning. Nationally it'll be Arch Manning, but I know for a lot of us Texas fans, there's other players that maybe are more interesting or more important to this season that we will be watching. And so, you know, whether it's one of the freshmen, Ryan Wingo, Colin Simmons, one of those freshmen coming in that you say this guy's supposed to be elite player. What do they look like? Is it a transfer, Makuba or Nyblack or Isaiah Bond? Is it one of them? Yeah, Rod's talked about some of the Trey Moore, some of the matchups you go against Trey Moore, seeing what he does in there. There's a lot. The running back room has gotten some love there. DeAndre Moore, I've seen mentioned on the text line because of all the praise we've heard about DeAndre Moore. What will he look like?
A lot of love.
So yeah. DeAndre
Moore, that's a good one. That's a good one. That's in my top 10. I got to, because I've heard so much about him,
yeah,
and I've seen clips. He looks like he belongs. I want to see it for myself, but right now I'm with you. That's one of the guys at the top of the list.
So that's who do you have? Let me know who we got it, and I'll put that on the poll on social media as well here in a little bit. But let me know who if I'm leaving anybody off the list that you guys say, how can you leave this guy off? Let me know on the text line.
If I made a top 10, it'd probably feature mostly edge rushers and receivers.
Yeah.
That I'm really interested to see, because I want to see a young Colin Simmons. I really want to see Trey Moore, that BGO, the first step. Texas has good tackles, so that'll be a good matchup. But the wide receivers, whether it's, you know, we just talked about DeAndre Moore, who's gotten a lot of praise, whether it's a young Ryan Wingo's getting a ton of praise, whether it's Isaiah Bond, to see if he can indeed be number one wide receiver. What about Jonte Cook? Jonte Cook seems like he's not getting enough love. So we're taking for granted the fact that he has got more familiarity with the system than any of the receivers on campus right now. He's got more production in the system than any of the receivers on campus right now. Got more chemistry with the quarterback than any of the receivers on campus right now. And it seems like all we talk about are the guys coming in, because there's a novelty and there's the newness, and we want to talk about Matthew Golden and Isaiah Bond and Silas Bolden. It's like, man, you got a guy there, Jonte Cook, who's been there, putting in the work, has already earned the trust of Steve Sarkisian, so he's in the circle of trust already. It does seem like, you know, we don't talk about him enough, but you know what? Maybe that's on Jonte Cook. Maybe Jonte Cook needs to make more plays in spring ball and spring practice, so all the talk is about Jonte Cook and not about Bond and Golden, those other guys. So, So honestly, I think, and now I just tell you, name three or four receivers that I want to see in the spring game.
That's what I'm telling you. We don't mention, you want to see how Savion Red looks with the weight and Sadir Mitchell with the, there's a lot of, look, and we got 2 weeks more. We'll talk about it, but let us know on the text on 512-447-3776, because it is, there's a lot of people that you're interested in looking at, but I want to know if you had to pick one person that you want to look at, who would it be?
I like that. Always a great conversation with the big fat poll of the day. My man Patrick also handles the Horn headlines. We're going to come back after the Horn headlines and talk about this Stephon Diggs trade, the big blockbuster trade. We said yesterday, we told you guys, Nick Caserio was up to something. Said he had cleared some cap space. You don't just clear cap space after all the free agent moves they made for the hell of it, just to have, they're not the Cowboys. They don't just like just randomly have cap space for a rainy day fund. That's not what he was doing. No, Cook Serio was up to something, and now we know what he was up to. He wanted to get himself a big-time, bona fide, big-time wide receiver, and he did that with Stephon Diggs. So we'll get to the Horn headlines here, get caught up and educated and informed with the big headlines of the day, and then we'll talk about the biggest headline of the day, that Stephon Diggs trade to H-Town. Hit us up, Patrick, hit the Horn headlines.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball begins their weekend series with BYU at Dishwalk Field tonight. Texas will stick with the rotation of LeBaron Johnson Jr., Ace Whitehead, and Max Grubbs for starting pitching. In the current league leaders in home runs, Jalen Flores and Max Ballou will hope to keep their hot bats alive against a BYU team that is at the bottom of the Big 12 standings. The Houston Texans agreed to a blockbuster trade yesterday, sending a 2025 second-round pick to the Buffalo Bills for wide receiver Stephon Diggs and two late-round draft picks. is the latest move by the Texans after signing multiple big-name defensive free agents and trading for running back Joe Mixon earlier this offseason. With the NBA regular season winding down, the Houston Rockets play a must-win game tonight against the Golden State Warriors. Houston is currently three games out of the 10 seed and play-in tournament behind Golden State. The Mavericks will be in action against the Hawks, looking to make up ground on a Clippers team who will have their hands full facing the Denver Nuggets. And in the MLB, both the Astros and Rangers are off today as the Rangers won their second series of the season against the Rays after a 4-1 victory yesterday, with Eovaldi pitching seven solid innings. And the Astros got the win over the Blue Jays 8-0, powered by Yordan Alvarez's two home runs. The two teams will meet each other for the first time this season, starting Friday in Arlington. And that is your Horn headlines.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the Horn headlines. So it's no surprise that Stephon Diggs was traded, but the if you look at the details of the trade and you look at what the hit that Buffalo had to take, it's obvious that Buffalo was, they were motivated to move on from Stephon Diggs. We remember last offseason there was a drama, including Diggs missing part of mandatory minicamp. Remember Sean McDermott said he was very concerned about what was going on and really didn't know what was going on, and they settled all that. But then there's been rumors and reports that Stephon Diggs is not happy with the way that he's being utilized. Matter of fact, Adam Schefter, I didn't send this sound, but I probably could send it to you later on. Adam Schefter even implied that there is a belief, at least maybe from Stephon Diggs' camp, that they were intentionally misusing him or underutilizing him in the offense because they were trying to prove a point that they could run the offense without featuring Stephon Diggs. That it wasn't, you know, it wasn't something that they were dependent on to build the offense. It was through Josh Allen, not necessarily featuring Stephon Diggs. Now, like I said, I don't know if that's true, but that's just the beliefs. And like I said, Adam Schefter is the one that threw that out there. So it's pretty clear they were motivated to move on because they're going to carry $31 million dead money hit for the Stephon Diggs thing. And they wound up paying an extra damn near $21 million in 2022 and 2023 for him. But that old saying, right? Divorce is expensive because it's worth it. So it was worth it for them. They wanted to move on. And it may not be a coincidence that they moved just hours after that social media post that you talked about where Diggs ventured onto social media questioning a fan's thoughts on whether he was a important part or essential to Josh Allen's success. And we can get into that if you want to, but some people believe that it may have been the last straw that broke the camel's back, if you will. But there's no doubt that the Bills took a hit here. And if they took a hit because they're absorbing most of the dead money on this deal and the guaranteed money that they have to give up, they already paid. The Texans are on the winning side of this trade because they acquired a ton of value. And that's the word of the day. You guys hear me talk about it all the time. Value. Every transaction, every acquisition, you want to try to be on the winning side of that so that you're just acquiring more and more value in a sense, whether it be in the contract itself, having someone outperform that contract, or whether that be getting guys on short, cheaper deals who are going to be, you know, veterans who are going to start for you, getting starter reps out of guys you draft in middle to late rounds, whatever it is. But those are just ways you acquire value. And this is tremendous value, Patrick. The Texans, they have to inherit Stephon Diggs' $19 million, I believe, $18.5 million base salary. But there's a $19 million in cash for this year, basically, that they owe to Stephon Diggs. So that's cash up front. But other than that, that makes him the 16th highest paid wide receiver in the league for a guy that's coming off a 1,000-yard season. And a guy that you want to contribute right away for the Texans who are in win now mode, that's not bad value at all. And we know they were in the market for a wide receiver. So essentially, from moving down 19 slots in this year's draft from 23rd to 42nd by trading out of that pick with Minnesota, Nick Caserio landed Stephon Diggs, moved a seventh rounder up to a sixth rounder, and then got a 2024 sixth rounder and a 2025 fifth rounder. That is value, a ton of it.
Yeah, and that's that's what you want to see from a general manager, is someone who is putting things together with a plan. And we can play this Schefter audio too of him talking about that. This seems to be that the trade with the Vikings was all part of a plan to make another trade and to get this, and that it wasn't done. Let's wait until the draft, see if somebody falls to us, and then be reactionary. Let's be proactive and go out and try and get the best players we can get now. And then when we get to the draft, we'll utilize the draft to get the best players we can. But we've seen one of the things the Eagles have done. You mentioned how Howie Roseman is another one of the very active general managers. The Eagles, every year in the draft, people walk away saying they were able to take the best available. They were able to take the best available, and they will get steals in the draft every year because they can take the best available players. And if the Texans, if you're waiting for a team and you go, I have to take cornerback here, I have to take this here because I need it for my team, or we're not winning games, then it puts you in a position where sometimes you have to pass on guys that could be great players for you, and you could be getting a steal and whatever else, that a guy falls 7 or 8 picks because of his position, you could be able to get him. The Texans are putting themselves in this position for this year, for next year's draft, to try and draft more based on best player available in positions, and then filling holes where they need to, but they don't necessarily need day one starters from this draft. So you can draft, okay, if we like a cornerback in the third round, but we feel that, you know, he may drop from the second to third, well, we can take him there, but we don't need to take a cornerback in the second round now in the first round, because we have someone, we've signed 5 other defensive backs this offseason. We don't need to take another edge rusher because we replaced Jonathan Greenard. We don't need to sign another or draft a linebacker right away because we signed Aziz. We don't need to bring in a running back necessarily because we traded for Joe Mixon. We don't need to bring in another wide receiver immediately because we did this. It opens up the draft to you where you have so many more options because you are proactive as opposed to waiting for the draft, hoping that everybody falls to you in the right way. And if they don't, you're screwed. And also, you look at the Cowboys now. The Cowboys had this problem a couple years ago when they were going to draft Andre Dillard, which it didn't end up really working out. They ended up getting a decent pick instead of Andre Dillard. The Texans, I think. The Texans were going to draft Andre Dillard. I'm sorry, throwing the Cowboys under the bus. It was Tytus Howard. Dillard. All reports were they wanted Andre Dillard. And the Eagles knew they're drafting an offensive lineman, so we will trade up ahead of them. And you saw that in the draft a couple years ago, that the Texans, because they were not being proactive, everyone knew what their game plan was. You were able to trade ahead of them and get your guy because you knew who they were going to draft. This year, you don't know. This year, it makes it harder to steal players because you don't know who's on their big board.
That's a great point, though, about that there is no urgent need really for the Texans. And when you operate like that, you can steal value.
Yeah,
because a great player drops to you, it's like, well, everybody else is operating because they're operating out. We need this position. There's an urgent need here. This is what we have to emphasize and prioritize in the draft. You don't have to operate that way. Great point about Howie Roseman, and I agree with you there. And the Texans, speaking of a Howie Roseman, who's always looking at that championship window, right? I always throw out the stat that no quarterback head coach duo have won their first Super Bowl together, outside of their first 5 years. Like, if you can't win in your first 5 years with a head coach quarterback combo, it's probably trying to break that up, because no head coach and quarterback duo have won their first Super Bowl. It hadn't taken longer than 5 years to win their first Super Bowl. And that's where the Buffalo Bills are right now, right? They've exhausted that 5-year window, so they're just throwing blank at the wall and seeing if it sticks. They got to reset the cap. They got to do a lot of other stuff. Truth is, you've extended, overextended yourself past that 5-year window. The Cowboys are getting close to it. That's why there's urgency there. The Cincinnati Bengals are getting close to it. When you get close to that window, naturally the CBA and the salary cap, the way the NFL set up for parity, it is going to force you into desperation and urgency. You're right there on the cusp of it. Lamar Jackson, the Baltimore Ravens, I believe, just hit it last year with John Harbaugh and Lamar Jackson. And Nick Caserio has studied the NFL. Anybody who studied the NFL even a little bit, they know this. The 5-year window is well known, and you must act accordingly. And now that he's hit on his quarterback and he's hit on his head coach, both rookies who won their division and won a playoff game in their first season as rookie starting rookie quarterback and head coach, which I don't know. I got to go do the research and see if that's happened. I know that if you go back and look at the last time a rookie head coach and rookie quarterback won the division and went to the playoffs, you got to go back 100 years. Like it's like 1920 something. You got to go back a long, long time ago. But if I think it's like Dutch Sterneman and George Halas or something like that, if I'm not mistaken. But either way, my point is, if you now that you've hit on both of those, now it's up. He's got it's Brewster's Millions. He's got to spend the money, and you need to invest and spend and spend and spend until you bring as much, you know, talent as you possibly can that's allowed while you have this discount. And the discount is you have a starting quarterback on a rookie contract, probably the biggest advantage in major American sports. And because of that, you know, you're getting your franchise quarterback at a 70% discount. What are you going to do with that extra money? Nick Caserio, Cook Caserio, he's spending. He's gonna maximize his title window. So I think for a guy who's made the most trades since of any GM in the NFL since he got to the Texans, that was the case in the draft last year. A lot of people believe he's going to be really active in this draft coming up too. If you're a Texans fan, I think this is just a sneak peek of things to come. This is how he's going to operate, at least in this window. And if you'll look at all the contracts, they're all short, 2-year deals.
Yeah.
Even the Stefon Diggs deal, they're only obligated in terms of the guaranteed money for a couple of years. Everybody they're bringing in is on 2-year, 3-year deals, because at the end of that 2-year, 3-year window, that's when you got to pay CJ Stroud. That's when probably your championship window is up. You're going to be close to that 5-year window. And I think that's why all the deals are short, because he wants all the money off the books when he's got to make CJ Stroud the highest paid player in the history of the NFL.
Yeah, and the hope is you have to make him the highest paid player in the history of the NFL, because he's won you a couple Super Bowls. And then add into that, you on the other side of the ball, the number 3 pick in that draft is Will Anderson. He's also on your team, and you hope that he continues to progress as a defensive end and becomes a highly paid defensive end. You'd like to be able to have both those guys be really successful. So that's mm-hmm. 2 guys you have to pay. So you have to clear off a lot of room to try and bring your anchor of offense and defense for hopefully another decade. You'd like to have those guys. So I'm with you. You have to be, you know, trying to be, but this again goes into being proactive and not reactive, and trying to think, okay, I don't want to put myself in a position where I have tons of dead cap and I'm trying to get out of bad contracts in 3 or 4 years to pay CJ Stroud. And I have to make this work, and I have to cut important players. I want to be able to make decisions each year based on where we're at and adjust accordingly to aim the ship the right way.
Yep, totally agree with that. And it that's what I think the genius of Nick Caserio is, his kind of rent to buy philosophy with players. He understands he's planning for success. He's planning on CJ Stroud being the highest paid quarterback. He's planning on having to pay Will Anderson. That's why all of these deals, even the one he signed with Danielle Hunter, Denico Autry, Azeez Al-Shaair, they're just 2 to 3 year deals. Because he knows when he's got to pay CJ Stroud, he wants a lot of flexibility and how he can do that, and what solutions he can come up with. Okay, one other quick question before we, because I know we're up against it, and you mentioned the Adam Schefter sound, because I want to play that real quick here. Adam Schefter, he dropped a little bit of what I thought was an interesting bombshell in regards to talking about the Stefon Diggs trade, but also talking about the Texans and how they acquired the draft capital to make this move, was initially in that Minnesota Vikings trade where they traded out of the first round. Here's Adam Schefter telling us how aggressive Nick Caserio and company have been making these offseason moves.
Happened here is a couple of weeks back, the Houston Texans mm-hmm. went to the Minnesota Vikings and initiated a trade in which they got out of the first round, got an extra second round pick, and they got an extra 2 in that deal as well in 2025. Well, lo and behold, everybody assumed that that trade was the Vikings initiating it so that they could go up and get a quarterback. But the truth of the matter was, it was the Texans who initiated that to get out of the first round, to get added draft capital in the second round the next 2 years, so that they could go be in position to make a trade like the one that they did on Wednesday, acquiring Stefon Diggs at what many people are surprised by the price in the end.
There you go. So the Texans were the ones that called up Minnesota and was like, hey, let's make a deal. I thought because of, you know, Nick Caserio's reputation, because he's made more trades than any other GM since he came into the league, and because of what he did last year in the draft, making more trades than any other team in the draft, I thought teams might be hitting him up saying, hey, let's make a deal, man. I got a guy here. We want to move up in the draft, or we have a disgruntled player in Stefon Diggs. It sounds like more the Texans are the ones who are, initiating these moves because of really the window. I think the urgency that Nick Caserio feels right now because of the hit, him hitting on the quarterback and hitting on Will Anderson and then winning the division and going to the playoffs and getting a playoff win the first year. I think he knows he's got something special and he doesn't want to, he doesn't want to wait. He doesn't want to lose the momentum they have right now. And it's phenomenal what they've done in just a short time. Okay, real quick before we go to Behind the Burner's Curtain next segment, talk some Texas football. I remember this from, man, this was when Stefon Diggs was with the Vikings.
Yeah.
And Brian Robinson, the lifetime Longhorn Brian Robinson, used to play for the Minnesota Vikings. He was doing a locker room interview with all the guys just around the locker room, and he's asking different questions. This was a segment they did. And one of the questions that was asked of all the guys in the Minnesota locker room was, which player would you least like to date your sister? I believe it is. Listen to this, and I don't know if the Texans researched this or not, but all the guys in the locker room seem to be on the same page.
Devin, what guy on the team would you least like to date your sister?
What the hell?
Diggs. What guy on this team would you least like to date your sister?
Oh, Stefon Diggs.
What guy on this team would you least like to date your sister?
Least like to date my sister, Diggs, 100%.
What guy on this team would you least like to date your sister? And I might add, you're starting to be the runaway favorite for this.
Well, nobody want me to date this, is it? I'm a great guy. I'm actually a great guy.
There's seems to be a few guys that don't think that.
You feel differently about me?
Yeah.
They just don't know me well enough. That's what it is. Just a bit. All right, who don't I want to date my sister? Weatherly.
Why Weatherly?
Because he's ugly. I knew that was coming. That was the problem.
Oh, there you go. So apparently, Stefon Diggs got a reputation. You do not want him dating your sister. All right. Any woman in your circle that you care about, apparently, when it comes to Stefon Diggs. But I'll throw this out there before we go to break, because I want you to ask for this too, Patrick, and on the text line, if the folks want to participate and jump in on this, they can too. Now the Texans have made this move. Are the Texans the team that most threatens in the AFC? Are they the biggest threat to the Kansas City Chiefs in the AFC now? Because some people believe that they are. I think Nick Wright is probably on that bandwagon. I think Keyshawn Johnson, I heard him say it. Lewis Riddick said it was basically Baltimore and Kansas City, the only teams he'd take ahead of the Texans. So what teams would you take ahead of the Texans in the AFC right now? What would you? Is it just Kansas City?
I mean,
is it Kansas City, Baltimore? Is it Kansas City, Baltimore, and Cincinnati? You still got Buffalo ahead of the Texans? Or do you got Texans as the number two team in the AFC right now? And keep in mind, last year, no team in the NFL dealt with more injuries than the Texans. No team.
Yeah, I still.
They were the most injured team in the NFL, yet won the division and won a playoff game. Let that sink in. I'll give you the numbers later on, but let that sink in. That's a remarkable nugget that nobody talks about. That they did what they did as the most injured team in the league, the worst injury luck in the league last year. Phenomenal job with the roster.
Oh, phenomenal job. I mean, yeah. But I will say there's teams you didn't list in there that are going to be up there that are trying to make leaps. We know the Jets had a bad season, but Aaron Rodgers coming back, that was a team that was supposed to be competing at the top of the AFC. So the Jets are a team that's trying to build up there. I know they didn't have the season, but they didn't have a quarterback. Yeah. So Aaron Rodgers turning the Jets, that's somebody. Miami is a team that is continuing to try and push. So that's another team that you have to put in that conversation. You know, the Bengals, I think. You know, you even look in the division.
Browns, maybe?
The Browns defense last season, if they play that defense the same way, I'm saying I think they're up a tier of teams. I think they're now, you know, I think it's the point of it's a disappointment if they don't win the AFC South. But I think that's more the discussion of, are you now the front runner for the AFC South over Jacksonville?
Not even a question.
But that's what I'm saying. That's where I feel more comfortable saying they're the front runner for that than saying they're the number two team in the AFC. Because I just, you know, I have not seen them produce at that level where, while I think they're really good, you know, I need to see that long-term success before I go full in and go full crazy Texans fan.
There's no time for your rational, lukewarm takes here, okay? We want irrational, hot takes here.
All right,
the Texans are the second-best team in the AFC, and they threaten Kansas City. That's what you do here. You're going with rational, very reasonable, moderate, lukewarm takes.
You want me to get the Texans 2025 Super Bowl tattoos?
Yes, just get it done. That's what they want. That's what the people want right now, man. You're coming with way too much reason. they can win AFC South, but I agree with you. I think there are steps to this, but they've already won the AFC South though.
They have.
So maybe the next step is they just won it.
But I think
want a playoff game. That's what I'm saying. The next step would be win multiple playoff games and then, of course, win a division again.
Yeah. No, I agree. I just want to see the steps being taken. And I'm not willing to jump off the ledge fully that trading for Stephon Diggs and signing Danielle Harry, that we're now Dylan Henry, that we're the number one team. It's not even close.
I'm with you because I've watched Patrick Mahomes and they still can't beat Patrick Mahomes. So we can get as happy as we want to be about an AFC title game, but they can't beat Patrick Mahomes yet.
Baltimore beat the crap out of him last year.
Yes, exactly. That's a great point. You're right. We're talking about Kansas City, the top of the big dog, but you haven't even necessarily proven you can beat Lamar Jackson and
I know they're going to be better. They'll be healthier this year, but they beat the crap out of them last year in the playoffs.
They beat them pretty bad.
We're saying that if you watch that game in the playoffs last season, you did not think they're two players away from beating this Baltimore team.
I will say, how often have you seen a team acquire a 1,000-yard receiver, a 1,000-yard rusher, and a defender with double-digit sacks in one offseason?
I'm with you.
I don't remember it's ever happening, actually. I'm not saying that makes them a Super Bowl contender, but I'm saying they have brought in a lot of firepower, man.
They have. No, I'm fully on board. I'm rooting for the Texans all season. I want this team to do well. But, yeah, I'm not getting the tattoo quite yet.
Didn't somebody – who was the guy? Was it – who was it? Was it Jason Terry? What player got a tattoo and then they won the championship that year? It was somebody for the Mavs back in the day.
I feel like it could have been. I gotta remember.
Do you remember this?
I remember it, but I can't remember who it was.
Okay, I'm gonna look it up
because I want to say I can't think of the guy's name now. But a defensive player, like a guy who played. I can't think of his name, but he was covered in tattoos anyway. So I felt like it was that guy maybe, but it could have been Jason Terry. That name sounds good.
Yeah, I think it was Jason Terry. Jason Terry was so confident that Dallas Mavs would reach the NBA Finals, and he had it tattooed on him.
Man.
On October 19, 2010, a day before a preseason game against the Orlando Magic, Deshaun Stevenson had a get-together for his Mavericks teammates at his house. Stevenson, who has an off-season home in Orlando, brought his chef and personal tattoo artist for the players. It was a team-building exercise. Stevenson's chest, neck, and arms are covered with tattoos. And Jason Terry, but despite all the tattoos, what he saw a teammate Jason Terry do was mind-boggling at the time. Terry got one placed on his right bicep of the Larry O'Brien trophy given to the winner of the NBA championship. When he first got the tattoo, I said he was crazy, Stevenson said. He said, I didn't say it to him, but I've never been to the NBA Finals. And for him to have that now, wow. And he got the tattoo in October, and it means a lot with what we've been through. So yeah.
By the way, the guy I was thinking of was Deshaun Stevenson. Was the guy I was thinking of who would have been the other guy.
Okay, so he was involved in the story.
He was involved in the story. That was who I was trying to go with.
Crazy, dog. That's wild. All right, I know we're over here. We come back. We'll get into Behind the Burn On Skirt, Texas Spring Practice News, Notes, and Nuggets on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Mike Tomlinson and Rod Davis coming back on the horn. All right, let's get into some Texas football spring news, notes, and nuggets. Let's get into some of the practice updates here. Shout out to our friends over at Owen Texas Football. Go to owentexasfootball.com, or you can go to the Owen Texas Football YouTube channel. My man Bobby Burden and Jerry Hamilton, CJ Vogel, doing a great job over there. One of the nuggets here from their practice report talks about the offensive line. Said there's been a more rotation, if you will, at the left guard position. We know there's a heavy competition there between Nato Umeazulu. Hayden Connor is involved in that competition as well. Nato Umeazulu was taking a lot of the first team reps last week. It looks like now they're switching up, and Hayden Connor is back at the left guard position. He was, I think, working at backup center, if I'm not mistaken, last week. So a lot of cross training going on the offensive line. But it points out that both of those guys, Nato Umeazulu and Hayden Connor, have both worked with the first team offensive line at their left guard position. I think they're pretty set that their best five offensive linemen, one of the, you know, at least four of those five will end up being, of course, Kelvin Banks, your anchor. Jake Majors is your center there. You got the right guard, which is DJ Campbell, right tackle, which is going to be Cam Williams. And I haven't heard of any real shakeups there. I'm sure they're cross-training guys, but that seems to be the consistent four out of your top five. The only question is who's going to be left guard. And I don't know if that position will be settled. This is a first-world problem, by the way, because I think both Hayden Connor and Nato Umeazulu both could be high-caliber starters for you. So first-world problem, and you're trying to get your best five out there, and I think this will be settled in training camp, probably not in spring ball, as they want to give both of those guys time to kind of acclimate, and I do think they want to give them the offseason to be able to try to separate, if they can, from the other. So that's a good problem to have, good competition. Also, another nugget here, Ryan Wingo getting love once again. He is definitely the most, he's easily the most mentioned, and even Sark is the one that was very complimentary of him, but he's definitely the most mentioned and talked about of the freshman enrollees, the true freshman enrollees. I don't think I've heard as much about any of them as I've heard about Ryan Wingo, either behind the scenes, from Sark himself, from the practice reports. And here's another one saying he's been very good, still working on his route running, but he's not backing down. He has not hit the freshman wall. I even brought out earlier, I read you guys my notes from when I initially first watched him, and I put on there, you know, elite balance, body control, location acceleration when he sees the ball in the air, he hits another gear. But I also wrote on there, not a refined route runner. Not really, I think he's not really knowledgeable of how to create separation through route running. He was just creating separation off freakish ability, whether it be speed or, you know, just explosive cuts, get in and out of breaks, accelerate it, next level acceleration, deceleration. But he can go to an even higher level when he learns how to create separation off running proper and precise precision routes, which he's going to learn in Texas. But even says in this report, he hasn't done that yet. And of course he wouldn't. It's just, you know, he just got on campus a few weeks ago. But when he does, he's going to be hard to keep off the field. And I wonder now, even with Sark mentioning him, if he's another reason we'll see that wide receiver circle of trust expand a little bit. So Ryan Wingo getting high praise, continues to get high praise from all the reports about the freshman and about Texas spring practice. And one other little nugget here, I know there's a lot of concern about the inside guts of the Texas defense. Your off-ball linebacker opposite Anthony Hill, your interior D line, with the loss of Tavondre Sweat and Byron Murphy, you don't have a true zero technique. You don't have a true nose on the roster right now. You know, maybe that could be Sadir Mitchell down the line. There's a lot of work to do to mold that raw material. Tia Savea, who's actually experience wise has played some of the zero technique there at Arizona, who's really comfortable in Johnny Nansen's system. And I'm assuming he's going to bring some of his concepts and some of his philosophy to the PK system as the DC. It says here the newcomer Tia Savea has been singled out as perhaps the best interior run stopper, at least thus far. that is a good sign, because that's what you're missing with the loss of the nose tackles. Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat can either, both of those guys can either play the nose. They were equipped to do it, whether with Byron Murphy doing it with the way he anchored himself with low pad level, or Tavondre Sweat just being able to do it with sheer mass because he's such a gargantuan human being. So Tia Savea, it is a good sign that at least from the run stopping perspective, he's a guy that if you're going to money ball that D tackle position, you already got one option there. Maybe a young Alex January helps you out there. Maybe Alfred Collins or Vernon Broughton can play it situationally to help you out there, depending on the matchup that you have that week. So maybe you can money ball it this year and you don't necessarily need to have that on the roster, a zero technique or a true nose, or you can go after that in the next transfer portal window, which I'm sure Texas will be aggressive in doing. All right, today you go. That's some Texas spring practice updates. Go check out ontexasfootball.com. That's where I got those, and they got a lot more up there for you as well. All right, we come back. We got off the record on the other side. Apparently, Tiger's getting real serious about his training, and we'll dive into that. Also, if we have time, we'll talk about the hot name right now in the scouting community in the NFL may not even be a guy playing college football. We'll discuss that more right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Davis coming back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time for our off-the-record segment. I got a couple of stories that I want to get into here. One is about Tiger Woods, y'all. This comes from TMZ. Apparently, Tiger Woods is he's remaining celibate for the time being, reportedly. No sex is being had at Tiger Woods' house, at least not recently, because a friend says that Tiger Woods has given up sexual relations in order to make sure he's completely focused on getting ready for the Masters. So in order to win the Masters, he's got to master his own domain, I guess. Be master of his own domain. I don't know if that's going on. We don't get into the detail of that.
Marvin Gaye would say it's a bad thing.
No time to procrastinate. No. You ask Marvin Gaye. Yeah, so one of the golfing legends' buddies made the revelation to the New York Post this week, telling the outlet that the big cat is training for the Augusta National this year like a madman. He's working really hard in the gym. He's eating right. He's even eliminated sex. He does that now when he's preparing. No sex until the tournament is over. He doesn't want anything to take away his focus. All right. Well, no sex Tiger. All right. Will he be better at the Masters? Will this actually help his mojo? Will he have, I don't know, a little extra oomph in his game because of this?
I'm no historian, but I'm pretty sure lots of sex Tiger was pretty good at golf.
That is fair. He did.
I'm just going to say, if he wants to win, he needs to go to the Cheesecake Factory again, start talking to some waitresses over at the IHOP, and then look, maybe the swing will come back to him. But
that's a young Tiger, though. Young Tiger could do that. Old Tiger may be tough.
He's got to feel midlife crisis Tiger. Can we get midlife crisis Tiger to get in there? Come on, you can't tell me that Tiger Woods thinks that the thing that was the worst in his life that he was like, no, remember when everything went bad and then my golf game started going down and my back was hurting and all that? Or I could just go back to being an irresponsible, crazy young man and maybe it'll work. And
just go back to being a philandering,
It'll destroy your family, but if you want to win the Masters.
They always used to say that about comedians, right? When comedians a lot of them would sober up. They would actually kind of lose that edge that made them really funny. They have to reinvent themselves in a different way. Yeah. I feel like Tiger, in a sense, did that. His own addiction admitted that he was got a sex addict, that when he got help for that, it did change his lifestyle, therefore kind of changed his personality, and he had to reinvent himself. And he was okay at first, but then recently he hadn't been able to, and obviously father time and injuries, I think, are a bigger part of it. But yeah, mentally, I think he's just trying to find that edge, and maybe not, he's trying something new. He's like, all right, man, you know what? I'm going to try no sex. Let's see if that gives me back my mental edge, right? my kind of spiritual edge. So maybe he gives it back. Who knows? That is, I know they used to tell boxers not to have sex before the fight.
That was the Rocky.
Built up testosterone. Yeah, women weaken legs, Rock. You know, that's what Mick used to say. So I don't know. That's kind of an old school idea, actually. So ain't nothing really new school about it. Who knows if it'll work out? We'll see. But that's
I'll tell you this. He's going to be irritable on the golf course.
Yeah, he will. But see, this says no sex, but does that mean, like I said, master of your domain? Like that's
I don't know.
Because
well, you'll see if round three comes out and he's all loose. You'd be like, all right, yeah, we see what's happening, Tiger.
We see what's going on here, Tiger. All right, we got you. Yeah, great point there. All right, so Tiger is not having sex. This former NFL player, and he was a great player too, Sean Alexander. I had no idea that Sean Alexander was so prolific on the field and off the field. We used to talk about Phillip Rivers and Phillip Rivers having, 10 kids, and we would mock it and, you know, make fun of it. Was anybody aware that Sean Alexander has 13 kids?
I'm not sure Sean Alexander was aware that he had 13 kids.
No, I didn't know this. He was doing an interview. We have the audio here. Patrick, play it for the people. He was on the Ross Tucker podcast and just admitted that he's got 13 kids. Here it is.
We had three while we was in Seattle, three girls, and then we came over to play with the Redskins, now the Commanders, and we had our first boy and second boy, and then I just kind of closed my eyes. I looked up, and we got 13 kids, you know? so So it's wild, man. A lot of work. And, you know, just like a good football team, you hope you're better, your stars, which has to be the older kids. They got to kind of get the whole team moving in the right direction, you know, and that's the only way it makes it work.
Wow. I have to go check. Is this all with the same woman? This poor lady. Like, she has 13 kids.
I like that. He's like, whoa. I just closed my eyes. I was like, do you know how babies are made? Because if you just closed your eyes, you're not the father.
She's fertile. She's a fertile Myrtle.
No, I just go off and play football for a season. I come back, two more kids.
That's what I'm saying. Like, he's working out and he's got obligations. Like, that is prolific. Like I said, the man is, I did not know that. I had no idea he had 13 kids. And I was
13.
I can't see anything that says, you know, these were with multiple women or anything like that. I think this might be one woman.
I mean,
he married Valerie Alexander in April 2002. Yeah.
Just,
I guess this is them.
Just
think
her. You're a friend of the family, right? You're not a ex-millionaire or millionaire ex-athlete. You're a friend of the family. You're talking about being committed to over a birthday a month.
Wow.
Because
you're right. Yeah, you're right about that. Yeah. You're right. No doubt.
Every, and you're just parties. Like, we just had one. There was parties. Just a birthday.
There's parties all the time. If you combine the birthdays with, because now kids have parties for all kinds of things. I know there's an Easter party now. Kids are having Easter party. Like, there's an Easter party? What the hell? I never had an Easter party when I was a kid. You can go do some hunting in the back. You can go hunt some of those Easter eggs in the backyard and look for them, but we're not having a party. No, there's a party now. So you got that as a party. You know, there's always Halloween is basically like a party. Christmas is a party. That house, man, you're right.
You graduate every month, you graduate every party. Single grade is a graduation now.
That's another party. Then you got your friends' birthday parties, because I got to go to their friends, and your social circles are really close because all the friends and the family friends. Dude, that you're right. That damn house, they are partying at least three, four times a month. It's just a party. Just for not some
the Little League team's coming over, and then the soccer team's coming over. Then you got Boy Scouts, and then you got you got to watch out because, all right, now the math club's coming over because one kid didn't take after Sean Alexander. So all the kids.
Dude, wow. Man, okay, there you go. So I don't know if there's a – I don't know if there's an NFL player that's got him beat.
Not with one woman, I can tell you that much.
I believe it is with one lady. And I'm sure they, you know, obviously they can have a surrogate and stuff like that. I don't know the details of that. But I'm assuming she had most of those kids.
You can't say, I just closed my eyes and we had 13 if there's a surrogate involved.
I don't know.
We adopted some. It was a very difficult process. I just closed my eyes.
Because he's not that old. How old is he? He's 46. He's 46 with 13 kids. Like, he's not that old. He got to work early. They got married. They got married in 02, it says. It says they got married in 02. If they got married in 02, they got to work fat. Now, maybe they had some kids before that. But they got married.
Yeah, so 13 kids in 22 years?
That's the math. That's the math right now. Let's say you had one before
Honestly, we don't even know. Let's say they're not even had their youngest. They didn't say how old their youngest was. Their youngest could be four or five.
Yeah, we got to go do the research.
They could have.
It does say that they had one of their kids pass away. The couple had another child who unexpectedly passed away at two months of age. That was sad. That's
very sad. Yes.
But. Yeah, I mean, so they've been getting it in these 20-some years. So, shout out to them.
Hanging out with Nick Cannon.
But Nick Cannon's got, like, a lot of women.
He does.
You know what I mean? He's got, like, he's got a group there. What do they call him? A harem or something? He's got – he believes in something else.
He has a harem, yes.
Yeah, he's got something else going on there. All right, there you go. So, there you go. Off the record. We'll come back. We'll get into some NFL stories. There's a mock draft. Mel Kiper's mock draft. We got into Field Yates has another mock draft out there that I think we should get into as well. The Cowboys having some of their visits, and some Longhorns are on that visit list. So, we'll discuss that. We'll get into Rod's rant of the day. We'll talk about the leap quarterback. Who's going to be the leap quarterback for 2024. And we have some NBA stories that I think are really, really intriguing and interesting. So we'll dive into that in the 9 o'clock hour. Lots to get into. One more hour left on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn. Rod Davis coming back on the horn. Welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. He's the Idealionaire. He comes up with the musically themed days of the week. It is a new theme Thursday, and all of these songs revolve around the theme of fools because we just celebrate April Fool's Day, and my man Patrick now wants to celebrate the fools because all the songs will reference fools or have fool in the title somehow. So that's trust me, it ain't easy to do that. So we appreciate my man Patrick with all of his creativity with the musically themed days of the week. Also, he came up with the big fat poll of the day. Patrick, let the people know what the big fat poll of the day is about.
Big fat poll of the day, and I put it up on X and Twitter now, so you can vote there as well. Which player are you most looking forward to seeing at the Orange and White game? And there's way too many. I can only put four on the poll on X. So, but you can list off whoever else you want to name in there. Tell us on the text line too, 512-447-3776. There's a lot of them. I know Arch Manning is going to be the national favorite that I think a lot of people will want to see what Arch Manning, and all of us still want to see what Arch Manning looks like. It's not that, but I don't know for our hopes for a national championship this season. He plays into it as, you know, needs to be a solid backup, needs to be able to be ready to go. But some other guys that are additions like Ryan Wingo, Trey Moore, Makuba, those guys are going to be much bigger additions this year. The running back room, how do you feel going into this year? You had Jonathan Brooks last year, but he goes down. How does CJ Baxter look this year? That's one. The wide receiver room, there's tons of players you want to see in that room. I think, you know, the defensive ends, if you want to see Colin Simmons and what he looks like. I mean, I could even say Colton Vosick. I'm excited to see what he looks like with a couple years in the program now and yep. You know, a couple springs under him. What does he look like? So just all those pieces. But for you, if you have to name one player, just one, because we're naming off a bunch, then who would you name in that?
Yeah, no, it's a really, really long list when you start thinking about all the different guys that I think Longhorn fans are excited to see. I think most of my list, if I made a top 10, would probably have wide receivers and edge rushers on it. Really excited to see what Jonte Cook and Isaiah Bond are going to do. But, you know, Matthew Golden is another guy, and DeAndre Moore, we've heard a lot about him. Even Ryan Wingo is getting a lot of buzz. Edge rushers like Trey Moore, a prodigy like Colin Simmons. I want to see what Ethan Burke looks like with another year. Baron Sorrell is another guy that should be getting some hype, should take a huge leap. So those are two positions that are supposed to be strengths for Texas, and I'm excited to kind of see that group go out there and compete. And they'll be going up against, you know, groups that I think are going to be a strength too, and competing against them. Right, you're going to have, you know, those edges going up against really good tackles in Kelvin Banks, and going up against, hopefully, if you get ones on ones, going up against Kelvin Banks, but if not, going up against a young guy like a Brandon Baker out there, or going up against Cam Williams. This secondary will get a challenge from those wide receivers I just talked about and how deep they are, because, you know, Terrence Brooks and Malik Muhammad and Jadae Barron going up against those guys, that'll be a good competition. So that's what I'm really looking forward to, is the competition between really high upside guys who have a potential to play on Sundays, future NFL players going at it for Texas in that spring game. All right, so good stuff there with Texas, with Patrick in the big fat poll of the day. We'll get into some NBA, some basketball discussion next segment. Raj Rant of the Day coming up later on in this segment. We'll also get into the Mel Kiper mock draft after the Horn headlines. There's a Field Yates mock draft out there, a two-round mock draft. We'll see where the Longhorns stand there, and some Longhorns on the visit list for the Dallas Cowboys, who will have about three Longhorns, I believe, visiting the Dallas Cowboys. And we'll discuss whether it's even possible or whether it is likely that one of those Longhorns will be drafted by the Dallas Cowboys in this upcoming draft. All right, before we hit all of those stories, let's get informed, educated, and updated on all the big stories of the day with my man Patrick and with the Horn headlines.
All right, Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas baseball begins their weekend series with BYU at Dish Falk Field tonight. Texas will stick with the rotation of LeBaron Johnson Jr., Ace Whitehead, and Max Grubbs for starting pitching. And the current league leaders in home runs, Jalen Flores and Max Ballou, will hope to keep their hot bats alive against a BYU team that is at the bottom of the Big 12 standings. The Houston Texans agreed to a blockbuster trade yesterday, sending a 2025 second round pick to the Buffalo Bills for wide receiver Stephon Diggs and two late-round draft picks. This is the latest move by the Texans after signing multiple big-name defensive free agents and trading for running back Joe Mixon earlier this offseason. With the NBA regular season winding down, the Houston Rockets play a must-win game tonight against the Golden State Warriors. Houston is currently three games out of the 10 seed and play-in tournament behind Golden State. And the Mavericks will be in action against the Hawks, looking to make up ground on a Clippers team who will have their hands full facing the Denver Nuggets. And in the MLB, both the Astros and the Rangers are off today as the Rangers won their second series of the season against the Rays after a 4-1 victory yesterday with Eovaldi pitching seven solid innings. And the Astros got the win over the Blue Jays 8-0, powered by Yordan Alvarez's two home runs. The two teams will meet each other for the first time this season, starting Friday in Arlington. And that is your Horn Headlines.
All right, Patrick, thank you for the Horn Headlines. We appreciate that as always. Also, like I said, we'll get to Raj Rant here and talk some NFL. We'll talk about leap quarterbacks, quarterbacks who are going to take that leap to be considered a top 10 quarterback. We've actually seen a trend where each year it seems like another quarterback or at least one or two quarterbacks take that leap. Who could it be in 2024? We'll get to that coming up in Raj Rant. I want to get to this Mel Kiper mock draft, and Patrick actually pulled some Mel Kiper sound, which was fantastic, actually. If you're a Longhorn fan and you're an Xavier Worthy fan, you want to hear this audio that Patrick pulled of Mel Kiper, because he is pretty much stating for the people, for the record, that he believes Xavier Worthy should be in the discussion to be one of the top receivers in this upcoming draft. Matter of fact, outside of the elite three that are going to be drafted potentially in top 10, he believes Xavier Worthy is he's the next class or the next tier of wide receivers right after that top group. So we'll play that a little bit later coming up. But Mel Kiper did come out with his latest mock draft, and his latest mock draft, he does indeed have three Longhorns being taken in the first round. And that'll be the first time, by the way, since 1980, if that is indeed the case. He's got Byron Murphy going to the Rams at 19 overall. That makes sense because they need a D tackle with Aaron Donald retiring. He's got Xavier Worthy going 26th to the Bucks at 26. So the Buccaneers are drafting a wide receiver. Baker Mayfield resigning with them. Mike Evans resigning with them. So maybe they're trying to bolster that offense. And they have a head coach there that there's probably some desperation now with that group just to try to win, in terms of the coach maybe on the hot seat if they don't get something going there in that division. And he's got A.D. Mitchell with the 32nd overall pick going to the Kansas City Chiefs. And we know the Chiefs are also in the market for a wide receiver. So there's a sweet spot based on these mocks, and even based on the tweet from Matt Miller, who does a great job as a draft analyst for ESPN. And also he has a lot of Longhorn coverage too, because he follows the program. I think he was a fan actually of the University of Texas originally. But he said in his latest tweet, wide receiver names to know in Buffalo because of the Stephon Diggs trade. All right. And no Gabe Davis. They need a wide receiver. There's a void there at wide receiver. He said, wide receiver names to know in Buffalo, Brian Thomas Jr., A.D. Mitchell, Xavier Worthy, Ladd McConkey, Xavier Leggett, and he points out Thomas likely off the board at 28 overall, which is going to leave you with A.D. Mitchell, Xavier Worthy, Ladd McConkey, and Xavier Leggett. So it looks like that sweet spot is going to be late in the first round for Xavier Worthy and A.D. Mitchell, which is awesome because that means you're looking at potential franchise quarterbacks like Patrick Mahomes and Josh Allen to be guys that could draft you. Even Baker Mayfield's not the worst situation for an Xavier Worthy, considering he's a proven commodity, at least in the NFL. But that's what it's looking like, Patrick, right around that late 20s to early 30s of the NFL draft. That's where Xavier Worthy and A.D. Mitchell might end up sliding. And now with Buffalo needing a wide receiver desperately, and I think a lot of the mock drafts have him going there anyway, it looks like they're going to be even more so prioritizing the wide receiver position.
I mean, it seems Buffalo, with Gabe Davis going to free agency, with Stephon Diggs being traded, you have to assume they're going to take a wide receiver early in this draft. I don't think you can hamstring Josh Allen that much unless they're ready to move on from Josh Allen too, and they're just blowing everything up. I don't think they're doing that. I think they will try and get him some help and further prove the point that some of the, that Stephon Diggs at least believed that they wanted to prove that they did not need a top wide receiver to make Josh Allen a special quarterback. So you could be put in a great situation, though, if you are a young wide receiver. And I know I've seen him. I've seen both Texas wide receivers go into Buffalo. Now we know Kansas City, even though they signed Hollywood Brown, Rashee Rice now has some legal problems. It doesn't look like that's going to be too bad, but he could get a suspension. But the Hollywood Brown is for 1 year. You could expect them to still draft somebody, try and get them ready, have them ready by playoffs, but have a little security of getting Hollywood Brown in there as well. But there's just a number of teams that in that late first round. The big thing you have to watch out for is if wide receivers start to go early, both those Texas players should be off the board by the end of the first round. If wide receivers get pushed back a little bit more, if you see guys say that they want to go for a different need first, that is a deep enough wide receiver draft that they don't necessarily need to have one of those guys. They have a lot of guys with a third round grade that they're not too worried about. They don't need to take a second round grade in the first round. Then that's where A.D. Mitchell and Xavier Worthy could get pushed back a little bit.
Yeah. And I think right now I feel somewhat confident that A.D. Mitchell and Xavier Worthy both will be drafted in the first round, which will give Texas three first-round picks. Like I said, first time since 1980 that Texas would have three players drafted in the first round. That's a hell of an accomplishment for Steve Sarkisian in his third season, already starting to change the narrative about Texas and their talent development. Field Yates also had a mock draft. You know what? Before we get to that, let's play the audio. So we're talking about Mel Kiper's mock draft. Let's play the audio you found, Patrick, which I think is phenomenal. And I knew Mel Kiper liked the Texas wide receivers. I've heard him say that specifically on NFL Live. He was asked, hey, what wide receivers do you think are underrated in this draft? And he said the Texas guys. Texas guys are underrated. He said that prior to the combine. All right, prior to the combine, prior to the pro days, and I believe A.D. Mitchell and Xavier Worthy increased their draft stock exponentially since then. So this is the first time I've heard Mel Kiper talk about the Texas, or at least about Xavier Worthy specifically. This is about Xavier Worthy. Talk about Xavier Worthy since the combine. And it was, honestly, if you're asking Mel Kiper, there is no doubt Xavier Worthy is going to be a first-round pick.
Where does he rank on your wide receiver big board?
I think he will be either right where Brian Thomas Jr. from LSU is or slightly ahead of Brian Thomas Jr. After we talk about that big three field, okay, of Marvin Harrison Jr., Malik Nabers, and Romo Dunze, he could be right in the mix as that next guy. You can't teach your coach the speed. When you have a guy like this, can he control his speed? He can control it. Is he consistent catching the football? Yes, for the most part, he is. He had the broken hand, and he had some drops 2 years ago with that late in the year. When he's healthy, he is a guy, is a fear factor player. 4.21 speed translates to the field. You can get him on jet sweeps, reverses, get him in space, move him around, and he is a nightmare to try to corral in the open field. So for me, the 165 in terms of this is his weight. Yes, is it a concern? Would you like him to be 175, 180? Yeah, okay. But what you have here is a dynamic player who is a guy who will give you a great attitude, great approach. He is tough. I watched this kid on tape, and what I like feel is when a guy doesn't shy away from contact. Say, you wish he would a little bit protect that body at 165, but he's a tough kid. We know how tough Malik Nabers is, right? Xavier Worthy is right behind him. So I love the kid. I mean, people will knock him for being 165, fine. I think you'd make a strong argument after the big three. He's next in line. He also has the return ability. You are going to get production with this kid, and you can utilize him in a lot of different ways.
All right, there you go. I knew Mel Kiper liked him, but it sounds like he loves Xavier Worthy. Now, he liked him prior to the combine. It sounds like he loves him now.
Yeah, that's glowing praise of all the pieces. Man. And, I mean, it's basically naming off everything positive about Xavier Worthy's game and then saying the biggest negative you're going to find, I don't care about. And I get historically there's not been a ton of great players that come in at that size, but there's never been a player that ran as fast as him at the combine. So we can say there's not a lot of, you know, history of a player like this, but there's not a lot of history of a player like this overall. And he says the same thing that I think Texas fans know and are hoping is the truth, that a lot of those drops late last season or two seasons ago were because of the broken hand. So the drop problems may be a bit overstated. He didn't have as many of those. Then he didn't even mention the fact that some people are talking about it, that there is a hindrance of Quinn Ewers' deep ball, that if you take away that, and I think they talked about it a little bit later with Field Yates, that if you say he maybe with a different quarterback that throws a better long ball and throws a better deep ball than Quinn Ewers does, that he could be even more explosive. So if you put him with a Patrick Mahomes or a Josh Allen or somebody like that who can put the ball downfield, that may even improve him more, because Xavier Worthy was working with somebody that wasn't their strength.
I agree with that. Yeah, I totally agree with the deep ball thing, because Texas actually, you can tell, Sark curtailed the deep ball basically the second half of the season, and they just weren't throwing as many deep balls. I agree with that, by the way, but that was an element of the offense that was essentially missing. He started taking the top off of defense in different ways. Remember those 20-yard curl routes they started running? Essentially, it performed the same task, and it was for the same purpose, to force that safety to respect the vertical route. So it served the same purpose. I mean, that safety had to stay on those hashes and stay deep, because you got Xavier Worthy, A.D. Mitchell running right at you. And most college quarterbacks, 95% of them, they can't throw a 20-yard curl. They just don't have the arm strength for it. It's too risky of a throw. When Sark schemes it open with NFL wide receivers and an NFL quarterback, and Quinn Ewers, a guy that can touch every blade of grass on the field, you can make that throw. As a DB, when I scout quarterbacks based on what throws they can make. I'm not going to defend a route you can't throw. If you can't throw the out route to the far sideline from the far hash, why the hell would I defend it? That's stupid. I'm defending ghosts. All right. So I'm only going to defend what you can execute. The problem is with Quinn Ewers, he can make every throw. So a 20-yard curl, you got to respect it. Usually I wouldn't even defend a 20-yard curl. I turn my hips, I'm ready to go. I'm running, I'm defending the deep ball. But I got to defend that. That is, for a DB, that's a mind blank.
Yeah.
I can say that right now. You're like, man, what the hell? These guys are running curl routes at 18, 19 yards. That's what you worry about in the NFL, not in college. Good stuff there. All right. One of the other things that Phil Yates, let's finish the Phil Yates draft. I thought we were going to get to that real quick. We'll just be fast about the Phil Yates. It's the Longhorns that are represented here. A.D. Mitchell is going 23rd in a trade for the Chargers, trading down. They got A.D. Mitchell at 23rd in the Phil Yates mock draft. He got Xavier Worthy going 28 to Buffalo. All right. You see a theme there. And he has got Jonathan Brooks in the second round going to the Dallas Cowboys. Also a very popular pick. I've seen it on NFL Live. A lot of people talking about the connection between the Cowboys and Jonathan Brooks, because their surgeon is the one that performed the surgery on Jonathan Brooks. So they got a little bit of inside information there, and they need a running back for sure. Okay, let's quickly hit Rod's rant of the day. And we'll talk about leap quarterbacks to plant the seed here and talk about leap quarterbacks. And then we'll get to the break and get into some NBA discussion. Oh, I know some Cowboys fans are probably going to know what the mock drafts have the Cowboys taking in the first round. Mel Kiper's got you Tyler Guyton, offensive tackle from Oklahoma, for the Cowboys in the first round. It's pretty boring for Cowboys in the first round, because everybody's got y'all taking an offensive lineman, and that's okay.
Yeah.
Boring is sometimes the right way to go.
But most two-round mock drafts do have them taking Jonathan Brooks in the second, so... There is,
yes,
you can look that, yes, maybe if you're a Texas and Cowboys fan, you may get a Longhorn there, because a lot of second round, like two round mocks, have Jonathan Brooks going to them in the second.
It just makes so much sense. It makes so much. Cowboys need it badly. They know more than anything about his recovery. They take chances, roll the dice in the second round. That would be a roll of the dice, taking a guy who's just coming off of a serious knee injury, but I think he's going to fully recover. And the value you would get, word of the day, value you would get for getting a first round running back one off the board in the second round. Ooh, that'd be great. And for the Cowboys who need, it's a position of need, that would be tremendous for them. So I can see that. All right, let's talk about leap quarterbacks. It seems like every year since like 2017, we have a second or third year quarterback take a huge leap, where they go from being a quarterback that's just considered a signal caller, or maybe a quarterback that is predicted to be a franchise quarterback to actually becoming a franchise quarterback, becoming a guy that people consider, or at least they debate, could be a top 10 quarterback in the league. Every year, it seems like there's one. So Jared Goff did in 2017. And it was a second year for him, but he took that leap with Sean McVay. And then obviously they went to a Super Bowl. Patrick Mahomes in 2018, he did it. And we know what Patrick Mahomes became. And that was his second year. Lamar Jackson did it in his second year in 2019. He kind of rose to prominence and became a quarterback that's considered a top 10, one of the better quarterbacks in the league. Josh Allen in his third year in 2020, he did it. Joe Burrow in 2021, they were able to go to a Super Bowl with Joe Burrow putting on his cape and proving that he's a top 10 quarterback. In 2022, it was a Jalen Hurts ascending to the ranks of being a top quarterback. Trevor Lawrence had a hell of a year, but it was his second year. Jalen Hurts, it was his third year. We did see Geno Smith, you know, become a good quarterback in his ninth year, but that's a different discussion altogether. In 2023, I think it was Jordan Love. I think it was Jordan Love was that third year quarterback who took his game from, you know, being a guy that was projected potentially to be a franchise quarterback to being definitely a franchise quarterback and a guy considered to be a top 10 QB. Now, 2024 was supposed to be easy because it was supposed to be, oh, it's going to be CJ Stroud or it's going to be, you know, maybe Bryce Young. But CJ Stroud already took the leap. He's already considered a top 10 quarterback of having an historic and unprecedented rookie season where he's already got cleats and footballs in the Hall of Fame. So my question is, who is it going to be in 2024? And actually, you can say Brock Purdy did the same thing. Brock Purdy was able to lead the San Francisco 49ers to a Super Bowl. So you had Brock Purdy have one of those breakout leap years as a quarterback. So who is it going to be in 2024? It could be more than one person. Like I said, in 2022, you had Jalen Hurts and Trevor Lawrence. Last year, you could say Jordan Love. Hell, you could throw CJ Stroud in there if you want to, or Brock Purdy in there if you want to, as the guys who took that leap. If I had to put money on it, I would say the leap, and as a Texans fan, I'm not happy about this because I think it could hinder the success of the Texans. Anthony Richardson, who started off like gangbusters.
Yeah.
We know he's a freakish athlete, but started off like gangbusters last year. Got hurt though, Patrick, but he's got a really good offensive mind there with him as a head coach. I like what Shane Steichen does offensively, and I think he's just got some of the best raw physical tools that you've seen. And we've seen that system work with Jalen Hurts in Philadelphia. So we know it'll translate to a skill set like Anthony Richardson. So he's one of the guys I would throw out there.
Yeah, I would say he's number one. He's got to be number one. If he can stay healthy, stay on the field, then he's your number one. Will Levis, also in that division, is probably somebody that you consider. Now, that team does not necessarily have all the weapons they need to have. They do have some wide receivers, but they're not a stacked team. And they're losing Derrick Henry as well. So they have to figure out the running game. But Will Levis, I think, would put on that list, because once you get past Will Levis, then it gets a little bit lighter of teams that think are really going to compete at that level where they can do it. Because Bryce Young, you just don't expect Carolina to be in a position for him to do it. Even if he improves this year, you don't expect him to be in that position. And then once you get past that, Aiden O'Connell? Yeah.
Like I said, you're right. It's a short list.
Aiden O'Connell is right.
Anthony Richardson, Will Levis, or Bryce Young. Yeah.
And then
Justin Fields
in there. And Aiden O'Connell in Las Vegas is probably the starter right now for them in Vegas. That's what I'm saying is that's his second year. He could be a guy. Right. If we're just saying quarterbacks who will start in that time frame, it's only four or five guys. And so I'll put him in there just solely. He's on that list. No one expects him to blow up. That team will be better than Carolina.
That's true.
The Raiders could be better than Tennessee, but I don't know if he's going to be better.
you're right. It's a short list of guys that it could be, because CJ Stroud screwed up because he had his leap year in his rookie year, which is not supposed to happen, but he's just a prodigy. And now I think Anthony Richardson, Will Levis, Bryce Young. Justin Fields, though, is one to watch. Let's see what Arthur Smith can do with Justin Fields' new leadership and a new change of scenery. All right, let's get to the break. We got some NBA stories we got to get to on the other side. Sham Sharania says the NBA is already ready to cross-market and cross-promote with Caitlin Clark. Also, there is a phenom in the NCAA tournament who may have aspirations to play pro ball, but if it doesn't work out in the NBA, maybe the NFL. We'll get into that too. And finally, we got some real NBA insiders who are jumping on my Wimby for Defensive Player of the Year bandwagon. We'll discuss that on the other side. All that and more right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn. Rod Davis coming back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn, Rod Babers here. Austin is a great city. It's one of the best cities in the country and one of the fastest growing cities in America. And as our city continues to grow and thrive, well, so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482. Many of the iconic landmarks we love in this city actually were built and constructed by the hands and the skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local Union 482, like the Pennybacker Bridge and DKR Stadium. The folks over at Ironworkers Local 482 don't just go to the office. They're the ones who build it. So if you're looking for an exciting employment opportunity or a refreshing career change, or maybe you just want to feel valued by your employer, you can become a valued member of this prestigious organization, Ironworkers Local Union 482. Right now, they're hiring over 3,000 people for a huge project right here in Central Texas. They're offering competitive wages, competitive benefits, and a pension plan. They even offer training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program. So become a member of Ironworkers Local 482 and take pride in the type of teamwork and craftsmanship that helps shape the future of our great city. Maximize your potential and accept the challenge of becoming the best version of yourself by going online and becoming the best version of yourself by going online and applying today at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm like Tom Longhorn, Rod Babers. New theme Thursday. Theme is all about fools, since we just celebrated April Fools. And now my man Patrick dedicating this new theme Thursday to fools. So all the songs reference fools or talking about fools or have fool in the title. So for all you fools out there, getting a shout out today. Let's get some audio here. That I wanted to get into early in the show, and we just didn't have enough time, but I think it's pretty good stuff. So first, let's get into the Sham Sharani audio here, Patrick. So we were talking about the record-setting performance by the ladies in the Elite Eight matchup between LSU and Iowa, and we know Caitlin Clark went off, and the Caitlin Clark phenomenon led to it being the highest-rated, most viewed, and most watched women's college basketball game ever. And I said at the time, I said, man, the NBA's got to capitalize on this. Her brand is huge. They're getting better numbers than some of the NBA playoff games. So I'm sure Adam Silver's already conjuring up some creative way to cross-promote the brands. And it didn't take long. Here's the audio, Sham Sharania dropping a little nugget here that Adam Silver's already ahead of the game.
Shams, you know, with the Steph Sabrina thing during the All-Star weekend, arguably was a highlight of the entire event. Are we going to get more of that, seeing how hype and how hot this women's game is right now?
At this point, Stephen Curry versus Sabrina Ionescu is very likely for next year. And next year's All-Star weekend, guys, it's going to be in the Bay Area in San Francisco at Chase Center in 2025. And I'm told with Caitlin Clark and potentially Klay Thompson to make it 2v2, Stephen Curry, Klay Thompson, and Splash Brother. I'm told Steph Curry has specifically brought up potentially having Klay Thompson in this competition for next year. Could a guy like Damian Lillard be a candidate as well to join Steph Curry? But those two guys potentially against Sabrina Ionescu and Caitlin Clark, those are all conversations that are going to continue to go on in the coming months. And as we get into the 24-25 season.
All right, there you go. It's already a buzz in the NBA. Kind of a 2-on-2 3-point competition based on the success of last year's kind of battle of the sexes theme between Steph Curry and Ionescu. So I like it. Patrick, your thoughts? Are you going to watch? I know you're going to watch.
I'm going to watch no matter what anyway. So I'll watch anyway. I would say don't bring in Klay Thompson. Bring in somebody more marketable and better than Klay Thompson is now. Okay. I would bring in somebody as washed as Klay Thompson who can't, I mean, the guy's basically, you know, they're trying to get him off of the Warriors now. Like he's at the end of his career. I would bring in a bigger name because I feel like it's maybe a shot to the women. If you're like, yeah, he was a good 3-point shooter. It's like we'll bring in Reggie Miller. You know, it's bring in someone young and exciting that you bring in. Yeah. I get Steph's the greatest 3-point shooter. So you bring him in, but I bring in somebody who's, maybe you could bring in Dame who's also older, but at least Dame is a bigger name. But I would try and find someone maybe that was a little younger that could be in the 3-point shootouts to even it up a little bit more and make it a little bit more marketable. But that's just me. I wouldn't bring in Clay. But
no, I'm with you. I agree with you on that. But I definitely think Caitlin Clark is going to be a part of it the way things are moving right now. Okay, so let's jump to the men's side of things in the NCAA tournament. Obviously, NC State is the Cinderella story, and DJ Burns, he's one of the marquee basic players for NC State, especially now going up against Purdue. That's going to be a marquee matchup, big man against big man. Well, DJ Burns apparently is getting a lot of love now. Jim Nagy, who was the executive director of the Senior Bowl, so he's a former NFL scout. He's done a lot of scouting and knows a lot of NFL scouts. Apparently, and Patrick, I thought you'd like this too. DJ Burns is getting a lot of love in the NFL scouting community. They're looking at his size and looking at his footwork and saying, that guy might look good blocking the blind side for my starting quarterback. Here is Jim Nagy and Peter Schrager of Good Morning Football having this conversation.
After all this stuff happened yesterday and all this, so your stuff's catching fire. Yeah. A buddy of mine who's a scout that lives in the research triangle there in North Carolina, really close to Raleigh, he texted me. He was like, man, you are killing me right now with these tweets. He's like,
that was his plan, secret?
His hope was NC State gets bounced in the first round or in the first couple rounds. Yep. And then he was going to try to sneak in and get over there and work him out himself. And you know, stash the guy away and sign him after the draft. He's like, well, now that's not in the cards, because you're right. If they had a pro day, man, over half the league would probably be there, I would guess.
Yeah. And here's the thing. And you said it when you were talking about it. We're not suggesting he won't have a fine NBA career. We're not suggesting he's limited and basketball is not a future. We're just saying, you see that body, you see how nimble he is, you see the way he moves in the paint. That is offensive lineman footwork, man. That all that stuff that he's doing, the drop step, all that stuff, that is stuff that offensive line coaches spend years trying to develop. You see it already with that.
All right, there you go. What is his NBA future?
I mean, I can't imagine it's great.
Okay.
I mean, he's a good player, but at 6'9", 275, there's not a lot of room for that. He's an inside player too, which there's less and less of those. You know, you want guys to be stretch and have bigger and more jump shots. And so I don't know. I don't know how much it would be. I'm sure there would be a place for him, at least in the G League and kind of going back and forth to see if he can go to that level. But, and I think this is a point too that people are missing, that this is not also, this is an NC State team. We joked about it, of guys showing up to practice on time and all that. I don't know if they're looking at this NC State and going, well, they had a run in the March Madness, so we should automatically give this guy an NBA contract now. He doesn't fit the mold of an NBA player anymore. He did, you know, if 20 years ago he did. But in today's game, it's just not that type of game right now. So, you know, as much as you're there, the question is, where is Zach Edey going to end up? And Zach Edey's the player of the year right now. And you're wondering where he's going to end up at 7'4" in a big guy. I know DJ Burns can get up and down the court a little bit, but without being a stretch four, he can't really play the five because he's just a little too short to play the five. And just, you know, it's imagine him trying to guard Victor Wembanyama, and that's where it becomes a little bit more difficult. And I get that's a, you know, there's weird examples like that, but I don't know if his, I think he's going to try. I saw an interview with him where they asked him about it, and he said he wants to play NFL, or he wants to play NBA. That's what he wants to do. He's a basketball. He's a hooper. He wants to do it. I think the question will be if his options are sit on a bus and play G League for thousands of dollars, or maybe an NFL team willing to invest hundreds of thousands and into you and, you know, maybe being on a jet and doing some other things in the NFL.
And they're going to let you sit for about 3 years. They're going to add like 20 pounds to you, teach you the footwork. So it's going to be a 3-year project.
Yeah.
So that means they're going to pay you for 3 years while you sit there and learn the game.
Yeah. So it may be, but I mean, it depends too. If he wins the tournament and he goes off and if he dominates Zach Edey in the Final Four,
people consider
it. You know, you're going to, I think that would probably boost his NBA chances for a 1-2 year run to see what he can do. And then who knows what you can do when you're in the NBA. But just body type and what the skill set is not necessarily the most sought after thing in today's game.
No, it's a good point there. Good breakdown. All right, real quick, before we get out of here, I want to play the sound of Draymond Green, because now I got another true believer on the bandwagon with me. Should Wimby be considered, and should he win Defensive Player of the Year, even with the record of the San Antonio Spurs being considered? At first, Draymond Green was not a believer, but now he is.
By the way, I know I said on here a little while back, Wimby shouldn't be the Defensive Player of the Year, and I lied. Wimby should be the Defensive Player of the Year because he is that amazing defensively. The way he impacts the game on the defensive end, whether it's off the ball, on the ball, it's a problem. When you start driving to the hole and like guys may have a layup, maybe not, and they just turn out and go the other way, that's a problem. And that's a block shot in a sense, you know, and no one will account for that. It's like a screen. You go set it a screen, no one's going to give you an assist. But the guy's wide open to knock a shot down. You drive into the lane and get a layup, and you see Wimby, and you just go the other way, that's a block shot. I don't know what lab he was created in, but I need to go create me a son in that lab, because dude is unbelievable.
There you go. He changed his mind. And you know what? Anybody can do it. Brian Windhorst is right now, he admitted that he's on the fence. He said, hey, I was originally thinking it was Rudy Gobert, but not so fast. He said, I haven't made up my mind yet about who I'm voting for Defensive Player of the Year. People are starting to watch with me. And there's a great breakdown by my man Patrick earlier in his show, go back and podcast, about why people are starting to change their minds. And you're saying they're actually right. Yeah. Wimby now is being utilized differently than
he was. And I'll give you the Cliff Notes version because we got to get out of here. But the Cliff Notes version is for the first half of the season, he wasn't. He had to evolve. He had to get better. The team had to get better around him. Now, in the second half of the season, he is Defensive Player of the Year. He is Rookie of the Year. First half of the season, it wasn't. So if you say entirety of season, Gobert may have an edge. But if you're saying right now, who's the best defensive player in the league? It's Victor Wembanyama.
Yeah. So are people going to be, basically victims of kind of recency bias? Is that what they're going to let guide their decision? Or are they going to look at the entire, season in totality, in its entirety? Good conversation there. Good point, ball man, Patrick. All right, we come back. We'll wrap it up. Put it in the oven. We'll let you know who said that on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Davis coming back on the horn. back to the Rodcast. It is a new theme Thursday. That's when Patrick the Ideanaire comes up with the musically themed days of the week. And the new theme Thursday, there's a new theme every Thursday, of course. But the theme for today, the fools out there, because we just celebrated April Fool's Day. So some of you were fools on April Fool's Day. Some of you have been fools in love. No matter what kind of fool you've been, it's dedicated to you today. Also, all the songs reference fool or have fool in the title or in the chorus somewhere. So thanks, my man Patrick, for all of his creativity. I also want to thank Patrick for pulling all the sound and the audio for the show. And because of his great efforts, we're able to play Who Said That? That's when we play a clip of audio from the sports world, sometimes outside the sports world, sometimes beyond the sports world. And based on the audio that is played, you can play at home. Hopefully you can recall whose voice it is and use some of the context clues, and then you can play Who Said That. So play one of the clips we got here for the people, Patrick, so we can find out who said that.
I don't think I'll be smoking for this fight, and I think I'm gonna be really, really irritable and nasty. And this guy's gonna come, he's gonna try to hurt me, he's gonna be greatly mistaken. I don't think he's faster than me. Whatever I'm afraid to do, I do it. Like right now, I'm scared to death. But as the fight gets closer, the less nervous I become, because it's reality. And in reality, I'm invincible.
I think that's probably one of the most recognizable, distinct voices in the history of sports. That would be Mike Tyson, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. He said he ain't smoking before this fight. He wants to be focused and ready. Ooh, I'm scared. I'm scared for Mike Tyson, but also I'm scared for Jake Paul. I'm scared for both of them.
Yeah, I'm scared for both of them. If he does quit smoking, if he does just go into the bad place again, I'm scared for both of them. But yeah, that was another great Mike Tyson line. In reality, I'm invincible. Is that's a solid Tyson line I was not expecting in 2024.
Wow. Yeah, you tell he's getting it. You're right. He's getting into the crazy mindset. He's going back to that dark place.
Yeah.
That way he was one of the most feared human beings on the planet. And I don't know if I want Mike in that place, because he was a genuine sociopath. I mean, he really was.
I got to figure out if I see if I can do it before, or maybe I'll put Ty on this mission too, to find all the best Tyson quotes and just put together a montage of just Tyson saying insane things. Because that in reality, I'm invincible. That's an insane thing to say.
It is a insane thing to say, but see why he believes it.
Oh, no.
He's been the most feared human being.
Like, I mean, the fact that he's still alive and going would make you believe that.
Yeah, him and Ric Flair. Like, it's like, you guys are invincible. I don't know how that's going on.
You got another clip? I got one more for you real quick. This was at a press conference the other night.
Did you say anything to him after that?
Yeah, if you block more shot, I'm going something, but he blocked like four after that, so I didn't do anything about it.
that is Nikola Jokic after playing the Spurs the other night, when he made the layup where he kind of ran out and backed out Wimby and went ahead of him and just threw up a layup real quick and was trying to get past him, and he was like, I told him if he tried to block me one more time, I was going to. And then he blocked me four times. And then he blocked me four more times.
Is the best like, part. And I didn't do anything about it.
It's like, you gotta stop doing that. Crap, he's still doing it.
Yeah. And that's the baddest man in the NBA right there. It's like, yeah, there's nothing I can do about it, right? He's gonna block my damn shot.
Yeah, that's a two-time MVP in the front runner for a third.
Yeah, no doubt. No, that's good stuff there. That's great stuff. All right. Thank you, Patrick, for everything you do, brother. You are truly the real MVP. Thank you guys out there for listening. We couldn't do this without you. We wouldn't want to do this without you. You're the most important part of the Rodcast. So I want to thank you guys for that. Remember, the revolution will not be televised. We're talking about it right here on the Rodcast. Everybody have a great evening. Enjoy yourselves. Take care of each other. Remember, I love you. We love you. And we do mean that. Until next time, peace and hook 'em.